and Pacific Time.
We now continue with a House Joint Subcommittee hearing of federal actions at Waco, Texas in the spring of 1993. Republican Congressman Bill Zeliff of New Hampshire co-chairs the Joint Subcommittee.
This hearing of the Joint Subcommittees will come to order. At this time, I would like to call the witnesses for Panel B, who have been waiting quite a while for the opportunity to have this hearing, and we apologize for the wait, gentlemen. I will call you in the order they're on my list, but obviously you found where the name tags are down there, and then I will swear you collectively afterwards. Ambassador H. Allen Holmes. Ambassador Holmes is the Assistant Secretary of Defense for Special Operations and Low-Intensity Conflict. The Defense Department's Counter-Drug Policy Office falls under his leadership. Mr. Holmes previously served as ambassador to Portugal and as ambassador at large for burden sharing. John M. Pickler, U.S. Army Major General. John Pickler was the commander of Joint Task Force 6, the military counter-drug force along the southwest border. Brigadier General Michael Huffman, United States Army, is the Army's Assistant Judge Advocate General for Civil Law. As such, he is the second highest ranking lawyer in the United States Army. Chris Crane is a Special Project Coordinator with the United States Army's Special Operations Command at Fort Bragg, North Carolina. Lieutenant Colonel Lindley, Philip Lindley, was the former Deputy Staff Judge Advocate for the United States Army Special Forces Command at Fort Bragg, North Carolina. Major Mark Petrie, United States Army, was formerly attached to the 3rd Division, 3rd Brigade of the Army Special Forces Group at Fort Bragg, North Carolina. Staff Sergeant Steve Fitz, United States Army. Let's see who else we've got here. Staff Sergeant Robert Moreland and Sergeant First Class Chris Dunn were each attached to the United States Army's 3rd Special Forces Group at Fort Bragg, North Carolina in early 1993. I know you all are already standing. If you'd raise your right hand, I'd like to swear you in. Do you solemnly swear or affirm that the testimony you're about to give will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
I do.
Please be seated, gentlemen. Let the record reflect that all of the witnesses answered in the affirmative. Before we begin the questioning of this panel, I'd like to announce that due to the changes of the rules of what we wanted to do today, because we did not get the unanimous consent this morning, we're now under the 5-minute rule, that we will have to drop from today's schedule the final or fourth panel, and we have been notifying those panel members of that fact. We will resume the hearings after the completion of today's testimony from this panel and panel C in the morning with this panel that is dropped from tonight. It will mean also that the schedule will slip for those of you following what we have, and the scheduled panel, second panel for tomorrow, not the first but the second, will be moved to the beginning of the week on Monday morning when we resume these hearings. And we believe that by that time we'll be back on schedule and hope that it all works well. At this point in time, under the 5-minute rule, the chairman would normally begin the questioning. I yield my 5 minutes for that purpose to Mr. Booyer.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm not able to see these names all very well. If someone could help me out, are you guys leaning forward, just turn them this way a little bit so I can see? Thank you. Let me first begin a line of questioning with Brigadier General Huffman. Earlier in an opening I gave this morning with regard to the Posse Comitatus Act, just to refresh my colleagues' memory, the Posse Comitatus statute is a criminal statute that states that it's a crime to use any part of the Army or Air Force to enforce the laws of the land unless authorized by Congress or the Constitution. Is that your understanding, General Huffman?
Yes, Congressman.
If you would, please, your microphone.
Is that your understanding of the Posse Comitatus?
Yes, Congressman. That's a basic reading of the Posse Comitatus Act. If I may interrupt for 1 second, Congressman, to say that I have submitted a written statement outlining the provisions of the Posse Comitatus Act, which I believe has been provided to all of you, and I would ask if that could be made a part of the record.
I would like to ask all the witnesses to note that even though the mic may be near you, you'll need to direct it to you. Since we don't have enough for everybody, turn it as, of course, is your turn to answer. Thank you very much.
Sir.
I'd also note that Section 375 here of Title 10 prohibits military personnel from conducting search, seizure, arrest or other similar activity unless authorized by law. You're also familiar with that section, are you not, General?
I am, Congressman.
Thank you. These statutes, the Posse Comitatus and this, they apply only to the active duty military and not to the National Guard when under state control. Is that correct?
Yes, sir.
The National Guard, as I understand also, they have three separate statuses under the law. Would you please briefly explain what they are and whether the Guard comes under the Posse Comitatus statutes under each of those?
Three potential statuses for the National Guard. One is Title 10 status, that's active duty when they are basically federalized. If that is the case, the Posse Comitatus Act does apply to them. Title 32 status, a state active duty status, which would not leave them under the Posse Comitatus Act. And Title 32, for example, where they're being funded by federal funds, counter drug funds. Last, pure state status, in which the Posse Comitatus Act does not apply to them either.
Are you familiar with the an after-action report by the Texas National Guard? Have you ever seen the after-action report?
I have not seen the complete after-action report. No,
pardon?
No, sir, I have not.
All right. I want to make you aware, though, that in their after-action report, that what we have here is on 14 January 1993, this is an after-action report. The subject, it's drafted by the Adjutant General of Texas, the subject, the after-action report of Texas National Guard counter-drug support in Waco, Texas. And on 14 January 1993, there were aerial photographs were taken by an RF-4, a Phantom F-4C aircraft from the Alabama National Guard. Were you aware that that had taken place?
Yes, sir.
Now, what I have here, this is a model of a Phantom F-4. Now, what we have here, you described that we got three different statuses. We've got the National Guard when they're on Title 10, federalized. We've got the National Guard when they're under state control on their own funds. And then we have that middle status when we have the Texas National Guard under state control using federal funds in support of a federal mission. And that's what we had at Waco, did we not? Was the middle.
The National Guard was, yes, being paid with federal funds under Title 32. Yes,
but under state control?
Under state control, correct.
Claiming to be outside the Posse Comitatus Act?
By law, okay. Being outside the Posse Comitatus Act. Yes,
so what we have here, ladies and gentlemen, is we've got this statute, a matter of policy of our land, to try to keep a separation between military and local law enforcement. But now what we've learned is that there are also memorandums of understanding between governors. So what we have is the Adjutant General in Texas getting on the phone and calling Alabama, and Alabama sends an F-4 across state lines from Alabama into Texas. Now, my question to you, General, does this begin to ask questions of, are we talking about violations of Posse Comitatus or not? Are we into such of a gray area here that it's really understandable why the American people are beginning to say, gee, why is the military involved in this one?
Taking the last part of your statement first, if I could, Congressman, it is easy to understand why the American people, laypersons watching aircraft with U.S. Army or U.S. Army National Guard, don't make that differentiation, nor should they have to. It's our responsibility to stay within the law. The second part of the question is your address to this action as being in a gray area. Certainly, in this statute, as in all other statutes that the courts have interpreted, there are some gray areas, but this is not one of them, Congressman. It is clear that the Posse Comitatus Act does not apply to National Guard forces who are under state command and control, and that was the case here.
Thank you. Mr. Boyer's 5 minutes is up. Mr. Schumer's just walked in. Shall I give it to Ms. Thurman? Ms. Thurman, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Colonel Lindley, after Mr. Crane notified you of the JTF-6 request for the ATF mission, you had some very heated arguments with JTF-6 attorneys. They even got personal according to your memos. Could you describe the nature of your concerns to us?
nature of the concerns first expressed in the memo, ma'am. There were, as the operation came to me, there were three areas of support which were requested. One was a review and a scrub, that is an analysis of the mission that had already been planned. The second area that we were requested for support included medical coverage in close proximity to whatever location this was. I didn't know at the time any of this was related to any sort of activity. It was a normal JTF-6 mission as far as it came down. The third thing was requesting assistance in developing rehearsal sites and constructing those rehearsal sites. The first two issues that came up, the review and the scrub of the operation plan, centered on the team that was present out there and the review of a discriminating fire plan. The second issue dealt with the medical personnel that were present there and being directly involved in potential searches of individuals coming through and the collection of evidence, as well as some liability issues associated with the treatments of the civilians, if you will, that were on the objective.
Okay. So do you believe your concerns were resolved? I mean, or how were they resolved? Or, I mean...
Ma'am, they were resolved satisfactorily by the time all this got done.
Okay. Sergeants Moreland and Dunn, let me just give you an opportunity here. It's come to my attention that there have been some statements made in some, I don't know, do you call these tabloids, whatever they're called, I don't know, whatever, that you were there and or there were some, you had something to do this. And did you provide any assistance to the ATF that went beyond the orders that you were given?
No, ma'am, I did not.
Have you been trained in close quarters combat, and did you provide this training to the ATF?
No, ma'am, I did not.
And did you in any way provide illegal assistance to the ATF during this raid?
No, ma'am, I did not.
And were you in Waco at the compound on February 28, 1993?
No, ma'am, I was not.
Okay. And if I could have Sergeant Dunn answer the same questions.
I was not in Waco, ma'am. I did not teach CQB either.
And you didn't provide any illegal assistance or?
No, ma'am.
Okay. General Hoffman, let me ask you, what kind of evidence would you have, to come in on Posse Comitatus? I mean, what kind of evidence would somebody have to give you, do you think, to be able to go or to provide your services or whatever? I mean, is there something written? Is there, I mean, what kind of evidence would they give you?
Are you asking, ma'am, what procedure is going through when someone makes a request for equipment or support that
That's
might
it.
Have a Posse Comitatus Act issue involved in it?
Yes, sir.
There are various levels of approval of this type of support, depending on what kind of support is being asked for. I think I would like to defer this question, if I could, to Ambassador Holmes.
That would be fine.
I'm just talking to you. Would you like me to take this question?
Yeah, I think you should take the question.
Ambassador Holmes thinks I should take the question. Which...
Well, I can tell you one thing. I can't answer it. That's why I'm asking.
And I think it's a wonderful idea, and I will try to answer it. Now, the level of support depends on what's being asked. The type of evidence, to use your term, you would need to determine whether the support requested was legal or not would depend on what kind of support is being requested. Some type of equipment can be approved at a very low level on a mere request by another federal agency that they need this to get their job done. Lethal equipment requires a much greater showing and a much higher level of approval. It's a fairly common sense, I guess, approval process, but it has a lot of different elements to it.
I know.
Thank you. Mr. Zeloff, for 5 minutes.
I'll be happy to yield my 5 minutes to Mr. Boyer. Maybe not.
Thank you, Mr. Zeloff. I'm going to go back to General Huffman for just a second. General, in fact, isn't it true that as long as the military does not become directly involved in search, seizure, arrest, that really military personnel can't actually provide a lot of this equipment, facilities, training, and advice, and there isn't necessary to be this drug nexus?
That is correct, Congressman. Both the Posse Comitatus Act itself and 10 U.S.C. sections 371 through 381 enacted by Congress in 1981 allow the provision of many different kinds of support to civilian law enforcement agencies by the military, training, equipment, expert advice. And the principal prohibition, as you mentioned, sir, is that the military is not to be involved in arrest, search, or seizure, or similar activities such as a stop and frisk.
But the real question here really comes down, if they have the drug nexus, perhaps they wouldn't have to do some of the reimbursement. Is that correct?
The drug nexus provides a specific type of reimbursement. It is not, as you said earlier, sir, required for the provision of the support itself. But even under the Economy Act, which is one of the acts one would turn to provide support to another federal agency, even a civilian law enforcement agency, there are waivers of reimbursement under various standards.
The Mr. Crane, you took the initial phone call from JTF-6 for the from the ATF's request for military training related to the raid on 3 February 1993. Is that correct?
Yes, I did.
When you received that phone call, you had some concerns about the support that was requested. Isn't that correct?
I did, sir.
Of which you then immediately contacted Lieutenant Colonel Lindley, the Deputy SJA, the United States Army Special Operations Command, to review the correct.
Yes, I did, sir.
Review the request?
Yes, sir.
Is that the right chain of events? Lieutenant Colonel Lindley, when Mr. Crane came to you to discuss the request from JTF-6 and the concerns that you had, and you answered some of them from Ms. Thurman, you wrote a memo, did you not?
Yes, sir. I started a chronology immediately in the event and kept it up through the remainder of the day, sir.
And your memorandum from record, actually, you just kind of sketched it down, and we won't pay attention to some of the spelling errors and those kinds of things. It's just really, you're getting it down for the record.
Sir,
right?
Just contemporaneous notes recorded as the events occurred. Yes, sir.
Colonel okay. Lindley, you're going to need to put that mic over.
I'm sorry, sir.
It's opposite direction. It's not your fault, but you're talking to Mr. Bouyer, and Mike wasn't there.
I'm sorry, Mr. Chairman.
I would ask that your memorandum be submitted for the record, if there are no objections.
Admitted.
Your memo was detailing your actions of that day, and as you indicated, you understood that the mission that was first given to you was not permissible. Is that your position?
Well, my initial analysis and what was presented orally to me indicated that there were some problems with it. Yes, sir, it was impermissible as proposed.
And then you ended up speaking with a JAG officer from JTF-6 who wasn't happy with your analysis. Is that correct?
He called me. That's correct, sir.
He called you?
Yes, sir.
What did he call you? Wasn't too happy with your analysis, right?
He wasn't particularly enamored with it, no, sir.
Wasn't enamored with it? All right. But he didn't persuade you to change your legal analysis, did he?
No, sir.
What ended up happening was they ended up changing the request, did they not?
I subsequently understood that. I never saw any subsequent requests, sir. I was involved in this thing for one day, and that was it, sir.
Okay, so you didn't end up seeing an operations order later on?
No, sir. I'm sorry. No, I did not.
Well, you should know that it was scaled back tremendously, and you're to receive a lot of credit for having saved the face of the military, and to your compliments, sir. Let me jump over to General Pickler. You were the commanding general of JTF-6 at the time, and the command specifically designed to provide the military support to law enforcement and the war on drugs along the southwest border of the United States. Is that correct?
Yes, sir, that's correct.
And in order for soldiers under your command to provide support for law enforcement, your command needed a drug nexus. Is that correct?
That's correct, sir.
When ATF came to you and said that there were there's this methamphetamine lab on the compound, did you just accept it on its face value, or did you do some kind of analysis? And if there was an analysis, what was it?
JTF-6 has, of course, had no reason to doubt the legitimacy of the drug operation, and we do not routinely question the veracity of credentialed officials for duly constituted law enforcement agencies. However, in this particular case, there were a couple of meetings during which the drug connection was discussed. One of those meetings was on the 2nd of February at Operation Alliance, which was the coordinating center for federal, state, and local law enforcement agencies within the southwest border region through which all requests for DOD support were channeled. And on the 2nd of February, there was some evidence of drug connection mentioned. Several things came out in that meeting and came out in a meeting that was conducted by the ATF in Houston, at which my JTF-6J3 plans officer, Lieutenant Colonel Jan Berthold, Major Mark Petrie, and several of his individuals attended in Houston on the 4th and 5th of February. The actual call that was made to Mr. Crane was made during the course of events when the existence of the request coming from Operation Alliance, instead of going to the Regional Logistics Support Office for simple equipment, Operation Alliance had four entities through which they could funnel request: JTF-6, the Regional Logistics Support Office, the National Guard, or NORAD, depending upon the nature of the request. Initially, the request itself from ATF went to the Regional Logistics Support Office. When it became evident that they might not be able to provide all that was asked for and that more was involved, ATF contacted JTF-6. And then we went through our systematic review process. We coordinated with the parent headquarters of Major Petrie, which was the 3rd Special Forces Group. We laid out for the 3rd Special Forces Group the kinds of things that ATF was talking about. This was my approved execute order didn't occur until about 17 February, some 2 weeks later, and during an extensive and a comprehensive review process. So that the coordination with Mr. Crane and his coordination with the legal officer in 3rd Special Forces Group was a natural part of that comprehensive review process.
I know my time has just expired. Is the operations order that Mr. Zelf had placed in the record, that was your operation order? Are you familiar?
The one on 17 February 2145 Zulu, I believe, is the execute order. That may be the one
in
record.
We'll look into that. Thank you. Mr. Boyer, your time is up. Mr. Schumer, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I want to thank the fine gentleman here from the military for being here, and I would say that I'm glad you're here because a lot of the mistruths that have floated around that came out from this article, The Soldier of Fortune, which I think a lot of my colleagues are asking questions about and may have been the blueprint for why you folks were called, can be debunked. I mean, just the question that my colleague Ms. Thurman asked, in Soldier of Fortune, in this article that alleges all these things, it says, you two, Sergeants Moreland and Dunn, were down there, and you obviously weren't, and there are travel vouchers to prove it. And this is one of the problems some of us have in the way these hearings may have been conducted, because you get an article from this kind of magazine, not known for its veracity, and then it becomes just played about again and again. But the good news is at least we get a chance to answer questions and set the record straight. Following along that line, I'd like to ask a few questions to you, Major Petrie. Am I pronouncing your name correctly, sir? Petrie? Thank you. First, you sat in on the briefings of the ATF in the days before the raid, mostly as an observer. Is that correct?
Yes, sir.
And in your opinion, did the ATF agents expect to be met with gunfire when serving the warrant?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Did the agents in the days before the raid, in your observations, fear that they were about to be met with armed resistance before the warrant was served? Or did they think they would, I mean, there are two choices here. One is that the people in the compound were going to fire back and it would be an armed encounter. The other, it was going to be, just as Mr. Ishimoto talked about in the last panel, I don't know if you heard him, that this dynamic entry, which ATF usually uses, would produce, in all likelihood, no armed resistance.
What I mean by my answer is that ATF was planning for that contingency, that in case they would meet some sort of armed.
But what did they think the likelihood was? That's my question.
I didn't really get a feel for that, sir.
Okay, thank you. And finally, did you see the ATF agents preparing to raid the compound in a manner which led you to believe that their intention was to shoot first, ask questions later, or rather were they simply preparing to serve what they believed was a legal warrant?
I'd have to go with the latter, sir.
Yeah.
From what I observed at Fort Hood, Texas,
watching some of the rehearsals.
Thank you. Finally, and I think this is a very important point here. There is, in my judgment, it is absolutely clear that no law was violated, no action was taken that comes close to violating posse comitatus or any other law. General Huffman, is that your, do you agree with that?
Congressman, so far as the Army's involvement in this, I would say that is correct. Yes,
that's correct, that the military, the Army, it's not even close, did not even come close to stepping over any line that might be regarded as violating that law. Is that correct, sir?
That's my opinion, yes, sir.
Thank you, General. And I would then I would make this observation, and then I want to ask Ambassador Holmes a sort of big picture question, and that is that even if, at worst, you know, we've heard a whole lot about the methamphetamine that may or may not have been on the made on the compound, assuming it wasn't, and even assuming the ATF, somebody in ATF deliberately misstated that it was, which I believe not to be true. Let's make it clear to everybody here. The only consequence of that, there is no consequence that involves any legal violation whatsoever. Mr. Boyer, my colleague from Indiana, says maybe it should. Maybe the law would be changed. That's a different issue. But there was no violation of any law. And the only consequence, if there, it was clear that ATF purposefully deceived you folks in saying that there were drugs there, was would be who would pay for the military equipment, the helicopters and other things that were used. That is clear. There is no dispute about that, as I understand it. Is that correct, Ambassador Holmes?
That is essentially correct, Congressman. Let me just say, I think we need to put a little perspective on this. Since 1989, the Congress has directed and urged the Department of Defense to get involved in the war against drugs. And every year has exhorted us
Ambassador,
to do more.
My time is running out, and I'm going to let you answer that, but I want you to answer another thing in line with that. And that is this. I agree with you completely. I dismiss as out of hand the kind of paranoid complaints that sees the military as a sinister tool taking over America. It's my judgment we're paying hundreds of billions of dollars for military types of activity. As long as people are not making arrests on the street, as long as they're not involved in civil law enforcement, but giving advice, helping other agencies do their job in the drug area for sure, and even in the non-drug area, it makes eminent sense with all the money we're spending for the military. What is your view, Ambassador?
Everything that we are doing in that regard is according to statute, and every official that carries out a request has very clear delegated authority from the Secretary of Defense's statutory authority.
And finally, you know of no law that was broken in any of these activities, do
I know
you?
Of no law that was broken
didn't
in these
even come
activities.
Close, did it?
I know of no law that was broken.
Thank you, Mr.
Thank
Chairman.
You, Mr. Schumer. I next recognize Mr. Hyde.
Thank you very much. I just want to comment briefly on my friend from New York's triumphalism at learning that the Soldier of Fortune article contains a lot of nonsense. Don't deny us a share in that triumphalism. The beauty of the hearings are to bring that out, and to bring it out for the country to see and to know what are myths and what is reality. So I would think the gentleman would cheer that we're having these hearings and we're all getting an opportunity to hear authentically what the facts are.
Well, so, as I said, it's a half cheer, Mr. Chairman.
Well, I'll try to get you up to a full cheer.
Okay.
And having elicited from you the concession that these hearings do have some merit, and that all any of us wants is the truth, and we're getting it, and I welcome it. I yield what time I have left to Mr. Boyer.
Thank you, Mr. Hyatt. It's always interesting that sometimes members always like to talk about conservatives, conspiracy theorists, and nobody recognizes that there are liberal conspiracy theorists, and they try to think that, well, if in fact there's a panel, it must be a panel because of some Soldier in Fortune type magazine. I've never even read the article. I've never seen the article.
I respect this panel. These are heroes here in front of me, and I'm very proud of your service. And I think it's important for us to hear from these witnesses so they can explain what exactly was the military involvement to inform America with regard to the Posse Comitatus statute and how its impact on local law enforcement. And that's what this process is. When I left off last time, General Pickler, I asked you if that was your operations order. Have you had an opportunity to review it?
I looked at it briefly
and
in the date-time group. Yes,
order?
Sir. It matches the date-time group of the operations order I signed.
At the bottom of the ops order, it talks about having the support from some of the highest levels this operation has the highest interest of BATF, Washington, and has been approved at that level. What does Washington mean?
Sir, in my opinion, the original support request that came into the rapid support, or correction, to the regional logistics support unit had a heading from the Washington office of the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms. And my recollection of the events included the fact that in addition to the ATF representative at Operation Alliance, who was one of the four senior representatives of that organization, it also had endorsement at the Houston office as well as Washington, because all of those appeared to be involved with the request itself.
All right. You were when I read your op order, there's a lot of mention about the drug nexus, methamphetamine lab. I take it from your testimony earlier, you accepted another federal agency at face value, and it's not your job and to question them. Is that kind of the?
That's correct.
All right.
In addition,
so when you accept on your face value, but although you were concerned because of some counsel that was provided by this by Lieutenant Colonel Lindley. And perhaps your own counsel at the time, and scale back. And so what I noticed, you were concerned with your personnel becoming too involved with the training of ATF. And is that why your execute order issued on February 17, 1993, indicated that the RSU would provide only tactical, which is company level, communications training, emergency medical evaluation training, pickup zone, landing zone training, and tactical vehicle dismount training, as well as a range control support. You wanted to narrow it, is that correct?
We wanted to narrow it, that's correct, sir. Due to the comprehensive review process and the systematic approval process that we go through prior to the approval of the execute order, that's correct.
All right, thank you. Major Petrie, you received this execute order from JTF-6 to execute the training at Fort Hood, Texas, did you not?
Yes, sir.
And did that order include reference to an active methamphetamine lab?
I don't recall, sir.
You don't recall? We'll give you an opportunity to read it. Sergeant First Class Fitz, at the time, did you receive an order from Major Petre to go out and do a study on how to take down a methamphetamine lab?
So we were directed to go out and do research on the dangers of entering a methamphetamine lab.
And how long did your research, how long did that take?
Approximately 3 or 4 days.
3 or 4 days, and you wrote a paper. What did you do? Did you write a paper?
Myself and another medic wrote a paper and presented it to Major Petrie.
All right, I see my time has expired. We'll come back to this.
Mr. Scott, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. General Huffman. The military mission and civilian law enforcement missions are different. Can you tell me what training military personnel have in civilian search and seizure law?
Military personnel other than military police have very little training in search and seizure, Congressman.
And when there's probable cause for arrest and when a warrant is valid and when it's not valid, they have very little, if any, training?
Other than military policemen, yes, Congressman.
Civil arrest, who's subject to arrest, and how to detain the subject, very little training?
Not areas of military expertise, yes.
And can you tell me, so that's one of the reasons that you don't want military personnel involved in civilian law enforcement, because they're not trained as such, is that right?
The reason we don't get involved in arrest, search, seizure, service of warrants is because the law prohibits it, Congressman. But you're right, we do not have the expertise either.
Are there other reasons why we'd want to keep the military separate? Not because it's a law, but just in general, why it's a good idea or a bad idea?
I think, Congressman, if you look to the beginnings of the Posse Comitatus Act, which I think has two bases in history, one of them was it was an attempt in the post-Civil War era during Reconstruction in the South to prevent the continued use of federal troops in the enforcement of civil law. Secondly, it was a reaffirmation of the civilian control of the military in our country and our history.
Ambassador Holmes, do you want to comment on this? Just generally why it's why we want to maintain the separation?
My own view is that this is a basically good government to maintain a clear separation between the military power of the executive branch and law enforcement power of the Attorney General.
Mr. Chairman, I yield back the balance of my time.
Thank you, Mr. Scott. Mr. Schiff?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. General Huffman, I believe you're Assistant Judge Advocate General for Military Law and Operations for the U.S. Army, am I right?
That's correct, Congressman.
All right. General Huffman, I have to acknowledge that I'm on standby status and my uniform has hung in the closet for the last 2 years, but I am also a judge advocate in the United States military. My uniform is blue when I put it on, but I think we have the same mission. And I want to ask you, although even if a support for local for civilian law enforcement could be legal under the Posse Comitatus Act, the military won't necessarily supply it in all occasions, will it?
No, Congressman, we will not.
Well, the military has its own missions to perform, so it has to, for its own internal policy reasons, limit the support it can provide.
That's correct.
General Pickler, I thought I heard you say, sir, that there was a necessity for a drug nexus for your command to participate in training. Did I hear that correctly?
You did, sir.
All right. Why was there a requirement in your command for a drug nexus to exist?
The mission of Joint Task Force 6 is to plan and coordinate DOD Title 10 support to federal, state, and local drug-related law enforcement agencies within the Southwest border region.
And you were the commander of Joint Task Force 6 at that time?
Yes, sir, I was.
Are you still the commander?
No, sir, I've had two assignments since then.
I'm sorry, did I let you finish your...
I've had two assignments since then.
No, I'm sorry. You were explaining why the drug nexus had to exist for Joint Task Force 6.
Yes, sir. That was the reason we were constituted. That was our mission.
It was a drug-related mission?
Absolutely, sir.
All right. And did your command in some way provide training or other assistance to the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms for this particular matter, the Waco matter?
We provided the support that's outlined in the execute order in terms of the medical support, the communication support, and so forth prior to the events of Waco in a category we call general support to law enforcement. Yes, sir.
And you would not have provided that support if there had not been a drug nexus?
JTF-6 or one of its tactical control units would not have provided that support, sir.
So what information did you receive that persuaded you that there was a drug nexus in this case for you as commanding officer to provide that support?
I received several reports of that nature, both from the people who attended the meeting on 2 February, from the people who attended the meeting on 4 February in Houston, and subsequently in the process of developing their presentation to me for my approval of the execute order. Evidence of that nature included the fact that certain members of the Branch Davidian group had previous drug-related activities, that precursor chemicals may have been involved there on the site, some pictorial evidence of the fact that a methamphetamine lab was alleged or possibly
pictorial evidence?
Schematic evidence. I believe that at the meeting in 4 February there was a pictorial evidence of the fact that The compound itself would have a methamphetamine lab in one of the ancillary buildings there, and that was what they expected it to be there.
My time is almost up, so excuse me for interrupting, General, but who is giving you this information?
We had the information from the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms and the Operation Alliance in their support request, where they submitted it through the Military Support Working Group, their duly constituted working group, to provide and coordinate that request to Joint Task Force 6, gave a statement in there that said that there would be characterized the organization as an extremist type organization believed to be involved in the manufacture of methamphetamines or words to that effect.
And that is originating with Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms?
Yes, sir. To the best of my knowledge, it is.
My time is up, Mr. Chairman. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Ms. Jackson Lee.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. There are a few operations down at this end of the table that I'm trying to maneuver, and that is these microphones. I hope my time allows me to get them maneuvered correctly. They're kind of stretching over.
Well, I can say either you may ask him or I will. I think Ambassador Holmes wanted to make a comment. I won't charge to you. Ambassador Holmes.
I will ask the ambassador a question, Mr. Chairman, and you can go ahead and yield the time initially, and then I'll be more than happy.
Go ahead, Ambassador.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I think it's important to emphasize that Operation Alliance is composed of all of the federal, local, and state law enforcement agencies involved in the counter-drug war. And it receives, JTF-6 receives 600 or 700 requests a year. These are vetted by Operation Alliance. And on that board, the senior members are the Drug Enforcement Agency, ATF, Customs, and Border Patrol. And so when JTF-6 receives these requests from duly constituted board, it's not their role to second guess any connection with drugs.
Thank you, Ambassador. You may now proceed, Ms. Jackson.
Chairman, thank you very much. I have made a commitment in beginning my questions as to reemphasize the importance of these hearings because, of course, lives were lost. And we've made a commitment to try and ensure that that doesn't happen again, at least under these circumstances. So, Ambassador, I want to just recount for you the information that I have about the assistance that might have been given, that was given, provision of training facilities and equipment, aerial reconnaissance missions, the use of helicopters during the raid, and advice concerning ATF's medical and communications plan. This is a summary out of the Treasury report. Is any of that in contrary to what the policy is with respect to assistance, if asked, by a civilian agency of the military? Is any of that inconsistent?
No, it's not.
Can you expand as to whether any other kind of assistance could be given?
The Department of Defense has had a broad mandate of authority from the Congress to provide support, and I emphasize support, to law enforcement agencies involved in combating illegal drugs. These requests come in, they're vetted, they're looked at, they can be requests for equipment, for technical assistance, for training.
But so this is not out of the ordinary, but the list that I just recounted for you is certainly not out of the ordinary.
This is one of five programs in the Department of Defense's counter drug program, which is part of the national program.
Appreciate it. This is about 3:30 in the afternoon, and maybe a little levity is allowed. I'm going to just say to B.G. Pickler, I was going to call him Big Guy, but I assume it's Brigadier General, and I wanted to make sure I had the right title.
Ma'am, it's Major General. Thank you.
It's Major. That's your initials. So I shouldn't call you Big Guy Pickler.
At the time, I was a Brigadier General.
All
somebody
right.
Saw fit to promote me, sir.
Thank you. I just wanted to make sure that I had the right title for you, and it is now Major?
Yes, ma'am, it is.
Major General. I just wanted to make sure that I corrected that. Let me, and I'll have a question for you. Lieutenant Colonel Lindley, let me thank you for making the system work. As I understand it, you asked some additional questions on having the opportunity to review some of the requests being made. Is that my understanding?
Yeah. Right now, this is the second time it's been said. The reason the system worked is because of the Special Forces soldier who was out there that questioned the tasking that was being submitted.
And
they had the foresight, they had the knowledge and the training ahead of time to go out there and raise these issues. And the real people you thank are the soldiers that were out there in the field.
Let me say to you that you now reinforce my point even more, because that was the line officer out in the field making the assessment. Let me ask you then, either based upon the line officer's assessment and then your ultimate participation, would you think that any of the requests, and I include things like reconnaissance missions, the use of helicopters during the raid, advice concerning ATF's medical and communications plan, did that suggest to you ways to kill better or to make the operation work if it was to go through?
Ma'am, it was a support role as far as the first part of your question, killing better. That's
well,
not
let me, it's a shocking question and you're hesitant to answer because you're not sure what I'm trying to get at. Would these support opportunities be offered to ensure that a raid, if it occurred, would be effective and the least amount of lives would be lost, or would it be to do the quite the contrary, ineffective and lives to be lost? Would you think that all of this that was asked of you would help to ensure less lives were lost?
I think a basic tenet of anybody in government service is to preserve life, and I think that this would support that concept, ma'am.
Let me go on, thank you very much. Let me go on to the judge advocate, if I might, and query you again about the question of the separation of military and civilian. I might guess that you might have been trained at the University of Virginia Law School, or?
Judge Advocate General School at the University of Virginia, yes.
And I can't join in with Congressman Schiff, but I don't have a uniform, but I am able to practice before the U.S. Military Court of Appeals, so I may have some standing here. I think it's important to try to understand why we separate out the civilian responsibility and the military assistance. Could you say for the viewers and listeners and those of us who are trying to get to the bottom line of what happened, it is a difference between dominance or dominating the civilian community versus providing assistance, that we are trying to keep a certain degree of separation so that we are not a nation dominated, run by, controlled by the military, but yet you are allowed to assist when necessary under, of course, the certain laws that we have?
Yes.
Would you expand on that, please?
Well, as I mentioned a little earlier, our founding fathers intended this separation of the civilians and the military. They did not want the military dominant as it was in Europe, and so the separation of the civilian control of the military became one of our tenants in the United States, and the Posse Comitatus Act is really a logical follow-on to that.
Did you help in Oklahoma City by any chance after the tragedy? Did you help in any medical way or any other manner might have provided any assistance?
The Army and the National Guard both helped in Oklahoma City, yes.
So you were asked to help and you did work with civilian agencies in that instance?
That's correct.
Ms. Jackson,
we thank you for that. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Time has expired. Ms. Ross Layton.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to yield my time to Mr. Shattuck.
Thank you very much. I appreciate that. Let me begin by saying I'm somewhat disappointed that Mr. Schumer is no longer with us. He was offended at a remark of mine last evening having to do with something I said. I want him to know that I have not only not seen or read the Soldier of Fortune magazine, I was unaware of any of its application to this hearing until the hearing started. So. Any implication that I'm asking questions out of the Soldier of Fortune magazine or its theories is inaccurate. General Pickler, let me begin with you and with, if I might, with the operational order. This is the order that Mr. Booyer was asking you about, and it's the order which has, in I believe the second or third sentence, this operation has the highest interest of BATF, Washington, and has been approved at that level. Page 2 of that order contains a sentence which I think is a good lead-in for where I want to ask some questions. About the third sentence says, intelligence indicates that an active methamphetamine lab and deliveries of the required chemicals to produce the substance of methamphetamines. So I guess it means the presence of those things. Intelligence in the military can mean military intelligence. I presume from your earlier testimony that this is not military intelligence that indicated that.
You're absolutely right, sir. It was not military intelligence, and that's one of the reasons that we don't question the duly constituted law enforcement, because that could lead us down the path in violation of Executive Order 12333 to the prevention of military surveillance or intelligence oversight of U.S. persons. And so we do not become involved in that kind of activity, sir. And so the intelligence was law enforcement related only.
And it would be a concern to you, would it not, if that intelligence were false or fabricated or based on information that was years old and clearly no longer valid?
Yes, sir, it would be of concern to me, but I had no reason to doubt it.
Okay. Mr. Crane, do you sometimes become concerned about that intelligence being inaccurate? And specifically, I'm referring to a fax memo in which there's a handwritten note at the bottom of it says, to reinforce SOF resistance to potential cheating, which seems to recur at JTF-6. Are you familiar with that language?
I'm not, sir. I'd like to see the memo if possible.
Do you know what the word cheating would mean in the context of the intelligence you receive in order to determine if there is a drug nexus?
Up until last Tuesday, I did not, but yes, sir, I do now.
Would you explain to the committee what it means?
Cheating would mean, in this context, a federal agency lying to another federal agency to obtain support, sir.
Yeah, that would concern me significantly. Lieutenant Colonel Lindley, let me turn to a different topic. There became a point in time, as I understand from your testimony, when you became concerned about this training mission and its involvement with methamphetamine and a methamphetamine lab. What dangers do you know to be associated with the methamphetamine lab?
First of all, it was a methamphetamine lab from the beginning.
That was the representation from the beginning.
That's correct. And for a number of different aspects, backing away for a moment from the law, just the physical characteristics of methamphetamine production and the dangers in the chemicals. There's ammunition considerations. If the medics were down there, the potential difficulties with an explosion of an ongoing methamphetamine lab, you can't simply shut one off. The second side of it was that the obvious production of tagnants and other evidence that would be present within the area that could be impregnated within the clothing would get the soldiers themselves involved in the physical collection of evidence.
Okay, and indeed, it's an extremely dangerous circumstance or situation, isn't it not?
Absolutely, sir.
The field officer that you're talking to you about, was that Major Petrie? Was he the one on the field who raised these concerns and discussed the issue of methamphetamine with you?
Sir, Mr. Crane next to me was the one who received the phone call. I believe it was Major Ballard who talked to him first, the special operations rep out at JTF-6. I subsequently talked to Major Petrie.
And did you explain the dangers of a methamphetamine lab to Major Petrie?
I raised that as one of the many issues that we were discussing, yes, sir.
Okay, and Major Petrie, once that had been raised with you, as I understood it, you took action with regard to those dangers and with regard to that issue in this matter. Is that right?
Sir, we were a little ahead of that game.
Okay. Tell us where you were.
When we had first heard about the potential or the possibility, Major Ballard, as the operations officer for the RSU, was my link on a daily basis to General Pickler and JTF-6. We were continually talking, continually sharing information. He's also very familiar with RSU operations as the operations officer. Roughly about January, when I was first given an indication, about mid-January, when I was first given an indication that something was up, that something was coming down, a few noted points were coming out. One of those was methamphetamine in terms of a laboratory being part of this objective for this, as at that time, an unnamed LEA, law enforcement agency. I then met with my own company staff, if you will, of two of whom are 18 Delta Special Forces Medical Sergeants. 18 Delta is the MOS code, one of whom was Sergeant Fitz. In discussions, I did ask that they produce a paper like that because at that time, sir, you have to understand that I also had, by completion of my tour out there, January through March, our organization had conducted 8 operations for JTF-6. There is some roll-off into some of the operations where potentially my own personnel could be exposed to the chemicals of used in methamphetamine production. Some of you are keying on lab, but don't forget that once the individual gets done pouring chemicals into apparatus or something like that, He takes that trash and he dumps it in some of my operational areas associated with other types of operations in support of LEAs. These dumping areas could potentially be or come across, my personnel could come across them during movement to and from. So, hope that answers your question.
That would be very dangerous. I see my time's expired. We'll pick up with this in the next round. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Shattuck. Ms. Lofgren, I believe you're next on your side. You're recognized for 5 minutes.
Could I pass to the next deputy?
Certainly. Ms. Slaughter, would you like 5 minutes?
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to read very briefly from testimony of Mr. Brault that he gave to Davy Aguilera, where he talks about when he first went to the compound and said that Vernon had said that he had found an amphetamine manufacturing facility, which he called a still, and that there were a number of documents containing recipes and instructions on how to manufacture amphetamines. The previous occupant of the property was George Roden, of great fame, who was run off at gunpoint, I think. But he had rented out part of the property, and one of the renters was a man named Donnie Joe Harvey, who later went to prison for robbery and was considered dangerous by the Waco authorities and was also rumored to be into drugs. Vernon Howell then said that he had turned these over to the sheriff, but witnesses who were with him when the sheriff's department came said he turned over nothing. There was a building that this man says from the summer of 88 to the time that he left, which was off limits to everybody except Koresh himself. And he said that there was literature in there, but never gave any other indication. Nobody else was ever allowed to go in. That building burned to the ground in the spring of 1990. And one night in 1989, when talking to a few of us, this man says, again I'm quoting, I was the only ex-member there, Vernon was talking about trafficking drugs as a way of raising money. He seemed very interested in getting money through this means. Now, I appreciate that this is the word of just one person who had lived there, but I'd like to ask, in your considered professional opinion, if you had this kind of testimony from a person, and that several of the people had mentioned that that lab had been there, that there was somebody connected there who had gone to prison for drugs, and there was a building completely off bounds to everybody else, would it have given you some pause that there might have been a methamphetamine lab there? Do you think that the idea that was there is totally far-fetched, given this information I just read you? What do you think?
Ma'am, from my perspective in talking with the people I talked to and refreshing my own memory and having talked to them, both currently active and retired, none of us had any reason to doubt the existence of a methamphetamine lab based on what we had been told and what we had seen at the meetings we attended.
The previous panel this morning said that they saw no earthly reason to think that there was one there. Is it your opinion that it was something that needed to be considered before serving this warrant and something to search for on those premises?
I think the existence of a methamphetamine lab was certainly very possible under the circumstances. And one thing that hasn't been added by previous testimony, I would point out that when Lieutenant Colonel Berthold came back from the 4 February meeting in Houston, chaired by the ATF and that organization, he presented to me another factor, which was that the ATF intended to include a lab team from the DEA in the operation. And so that certainly further endorsed our own understanding of the potential for methamphetamine production. And the lab team would have then been constituted to handle those kinds of precursor chemicals and the dangerous chemicals that might exist in that kind of an operation.
One other thing that I want to ask you really sort of goes to state of mind, and it may not be anything that you can answer, but during the planning of this raid and your interaction with people who were planning it, was there ever indication on your that you could see on their part that it ever occurred to them that they would be met with gunfire or that they would need their own guns when they went out to serve this warrant? During the training, were they prepared to go in shooting? It's really the question I want to get at.
I didn't get that indication. in observing the rehearsals and some of the training they were going under. I think, as I stated earlier, they were prepared for the eventuality of that, but
That it might happen, but that was not discussed at all during the planning at all. As far as you know, they had a sense they could go out and serve that warrant and walk away.
To the best of my knowledge, that's correct.
Thank you very much. I can yield the rest of my time to Mr.
I think your time has expired.
Has it?
You came close, but...
All right, thank you.
At this time, I recognize Mr. Coble for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, I will yield 5 minutes to the gentleman from Arizona, Mr. Shattuck.
Thank you, Mr. Coble. I certainly appreciate it. First of all, members of the panel, let us apologize for the structure of this. It's forced upon us. It causes us to break up the sequence of the questioning, but let me pick up where I left off. As I understand it, the individual to whom we next turned this process was Staff Sergeant Fitz. Is that right? You were charged with writing a paper. Am I correct?
Yes, sir.
Okay. And tell me briefly, what did the paper say? What was your goal in writing the paper?
First, sir, the goal of writing the paper was to inform my commander and the other detachments assigned to our company the hazards associated with coming across a methamphetamine lab while out on movement.
And who instructed you to prepare that paper?
At the instruction of my commander, Major Petrie.
Okay. Now, do you know what happened with that paper? What was done with it?
After review by Major Petrie, we took it to Houston with us for the meeting, and then it was presented to the ATF.
Okay. So the paper was presented to the ATF at a meeting in Houston?
Yes, sir.
Okay. And did you discuss the paper with them?
No, sir. I never discussed the paper with them.
But you were present at that meeting?
Yes, sir.
Okay. After that meeting, was there further discussion with ATF about the issue of a methamphetamine lab, and were they were afforded an opportunity to read the paper?
Not in the short amount of time that we were there. Would they have had a chance to read the paper?
There was a subsequent meeting, however?
No, sir. I mean, not until the team went to Fort Hood, Texas.
Not until the team went to Fort Hood, Texas. Was there a point in time when you reached any conclusions about ATF's response to that paper?
I never got a feeling from them, sir, as to the response to the paper. I never had discussions with them about the paper. But let me say, at the same time, I was trying to do research through a book to understand my role better so I could do my job more completely. So I never gave them the opportunity either to discuss it with me.
Well, maybe I'm confused here, but my understanding is that either directly or through other members of the military that were involved in this project, you had contact with ATF, and it became pretty evident to you that ATF was not worried about the concerns expressed in your paper. Isn't that correct?
Sir, my impression was that they were not worried about the methamphetamine lab, no.
Your impression was that they were not worried about it?
Yes, sir.
Okay, and you drew that based on further contact with the ATF?
Through the discussions during the Houston meeting.
Further discussions during the Houston meeting?
Yes, sir.
In what regard? They just didn't seem too concerned about it at the Houston meeting?
Well, sir, like I said before, I was doing research in a book, so I did not pay attention entirely to discussions going on between their raid leaders and Major Petrie. So they might have discussed it further, but I did not ever hear it discussed again myself.
Sorry,
sir.
Did the ATF ever, to your knowledge, express any concern about the dangers that were presented by a methamphetamine lab?
Not to my knowledge, no, sir.
Did you reach a conclusion that perhaps they didn't themselves believe there was a methamphetamine lab present?
I don't know if I ever reached a conclusion along those lines or not, sir.
Well, let me put it differently. Did anything in their conduct following your handing them the paper suggest that they were indeed concerned about the presence of a methamphetamine lab and the dangers that were exposed as a result of a lab being there?
No, sir, nothing in the conduct would indicate that.
Is there anybody else there who can say to me that the BATF reacted in a conscientious way and did things that evidenced their concern about the presence of the dangers as detailed in Staff Sergeant Fitz's memo?
In terms of chronology, the next time I heard or discussed anything or listened to anything from the ATF reference the methamphetamine lab was when we were also attempting to get clearance at Fort Hood for the use of flashbangs with the Fort Hood range control.
Mr. Fitz, let me just go back to this one more time. In discussions with committee staff, I thought, it is my understanding, you made it clear to at least the staff that the BATF pretty well blew off the issue of there being a methamphetamine lab.
Yes, sir, I said, and the impression I received that they, once the paper was presented, they no longer showed an interest in the methamphetamine lab.
From that point forward, they didn't show any interest in a methamphetamine lab?
To me, sir, yes, sir.
Thank you very much. I have nothing further.
Thank you very much. Mr. Taylor, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm curious, I want to open this up to the panel. Are you prohibited by law from training law enforcement agents from other, either U.S. government agencies or local law enforcement agencies? If they come to you and say, we'd like to learn how to shoot our M16s, can you teach them that? If they come to you and say, we'd like to learn a little bit about survival training should one of our guys get lost in a national forest, if they come to you for any of those reasons, can you train them by law?
Yes, Congressman, we can. None of those will be prohibited by the Posse Comitatus Act.
Does that happen on a fairly regular basis?
Yes, fairly frequently, but those specific requests, I'm not certain, but requests from law enforcement.
But requests like that. Yes. I mean, the great resources of the Department of Defense and the great training and expertise that's available, doesn't it make sense to make that available to protect the citizenry of this country? Yes, sir, Mr. Van Brussel.
Congressman, there is a, by law, there is a wide range of activities, of support activities, which law enforcement agencies, federal, state, local, either involved with counter-drug or not, or other law enforcement problems, they can come and request that to the Defense Department at any number of levels.
Well, let me make a specific then. You have the ATF, and they know they're going into a compound, and they know the guy's got probably 100 fully automatic weapons. And they know he's got a dangerous history because he shot at the previous preacher there. And they know that he has told a special agent he's not going to be taken alive. He's not going back. So they come to the special forces, or they come to the Army, and they say, can you teach us very briefly what you know about getting into a building? Is that legal for them to do that?
Well, since we have a particular case involved here known as Waco, I would like to ask General Pickard to answer that question.
Okay, but ignoring the talk of the amphetamine labs. What if they just came to you and said, we have a person that is dangerous, suicidal, he's got a lot of people with him, we need some expertise on how to get into that building. Can you teach us that? Is it legal?
Yes, I would say, General Huffman may have a different view, but I would say that is legal, but normally it doesn't happen that way.
Okay,
I mean, normally what happens is that law enforcement comes to the Defense Department and asks for Sheriff's Department, various people to be included in the next MP school course on X, Y, or Z. That's normally the way it happens. But this is certainly legal activity to render support to law enforcement.
Okay, but had that happened, it would have been legal, is what you tell me.
Had what happened?
Had the ATF just come to you without even mentioning the amphetamine lab and said, we have a situation. We understand you're experts at this. Tell us how we do it. You can tell them. Is that not correct?
Yeah. I think what you're looking for is whether or not there a drug connection is required, and it isn't.
Okay.
I mean, can be.
I want that for the record, that the drug connection is not required. General, and I want to open this up to the panel. I'm very concerned that some groups out there are going to great extents to paint you, the ATF and the law enforcement of this country, is the bad guys. And that troubles me because I think you're the good guys. So let me just ask this panel. Did any of you participate in the raid, or do any of you know of anyone else in the armed forces of the United States of America on active duty with the United States of America, the Texas National Guard, who participated in this raid? Second question is, and I'm going to ask this of every single panel that comes for the remainder of this hearing. Has anything that any of you have heard or seen or read justify the murder of 4 ATF agents and the wounding of 20 more in the serving of that warrant?
And Mr. Taylor, before you get on to the answer to that second question, the record cannot show the answers of the collective panel. Would you mind, for the record, going down the list? I'll give you the time.
Absolutely.
And getting an answer to that first question about whether that person knows whether or not there was any active duty military personnel at the scene of the Waco raid on February 28, 1993.
No, participate. Or sir. Those reporters didn't participate in the raid. They were witnesses.
Well, that's true.
Big difference between...
No, sir, I did not know of anyone at Waco at the raid, and I was not there, sir.
Lieutenant Carl?
Sir, I was in Fort Bragg the entire time, and I have no knowledge.
Sir, I have no knowledge of any active duty participation.
If you don't mind, Mr. Chairman, I'll say their names for the record. We'll go back first with Staff Sergeant Moreland, second was Mr. Crane, third was Lieutenant Colonel Lindley, Brigadier General Huffman.
No, Congressman, I was not there, and I know of no one who participated in the raid.
Major General Pickler?
Sir, I was not there, and I know of no one in JTF-6 or under my tactical control who participated in the raid.
Major Petrie?
No, sir, I was not there. I know of no one who was, and there I can guarantee you that nobody in my command was there.
If you other two gentlemen, your name tags are turned away from me, so if you would identify yourselves.
I'm Sergeant First Class Dunn. No, I was not there, and I know of no other active duty military that were there.
Staff Sergeant Fitz, I was not there, and I know of no one who was.
Okay. Did not answer. Would you answer that too, please?
I wasn't even in the Defense Department that time, but to the best of my knowledge, I know of no.
Okay, if you would answer the second question too.
I think this is very important to clarify the record. That's part of why these hearings are going on.
Thank you.
Are to make this record clear, and I don't think there's anybody on either side of the aisle that doesn't want it to be that way. So please, you ask the question.
As people who are sworn to defend and uphold the Constitution of the United States, has anything that you have seen, anything that you have heard or read, justify the murder of 4 ATF agents and the wounding of 20 more in the serving of the warrant on and again, the murder by David Koresh and his followers as they served a warrant on the February 28th. Do any of y'all think you saw anything that justifies that?
You can answer collectively or individually to that. I don't think we need to go down the road for this purpose. If anybody there knows that...
Would you like me to call the roll? Would you prefer that?
Volunteer.
I'll call the roll. Sergeant Marlin?
No, sir.
Mr. Crane?
Absolutely not.
Lieutenant Colonel Linden?
No.
Brigadier General Huffman?
No, Congressman.
Ambassador Holmes?
No.
Major General
Pickler? No, sir.
Major Petrie?
No, sir.
Sergeant, I wish you'd turn your name. I'm sorry.
No, sir, I know of nothing.
Staff Sergeant Fitz?
No, sir, I did not.
Thank you very much.
Your time is up, Mr. Taylor. Thank you for the questions. Mr. Boyer, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. One thing I want to get cleared up, because I think Treasury's playing games with the committee, and that deals with our request for documents, Mr. Chairman. When we have General Pickler here in his testimony, something was stated that bothers me. The subcommittee asked ATF for all evidence of precursor chemicals. None of the documents for which we have says anything with regard to precursor chemicals. Major General Pickler testifies that you were at a meeting where they said that there were precursor chemicals. So let's clear the air here on whether that happened or not.
No, sir, I was not at the meeting. My personnel were at the meeting, and during which precursor chemicals were discussed as one of the elements of the possibility of the existence of a methamphetamine lab, sir.
All right, thank you. And if there's anyone from Treasury here, if there are any documents to that, we would appreciate it. Otherwise, we'll continue to go after Treasury on their conduct. Let me ask questions to Major Petrie. Did you or your team ever provide any training other than that directed in the JTF-6 operation order that you're aware of?
No, sir.
Were you or your team ever asked by ATF to provide any other forms of additional support?
Just earlier on in the initial, the 2 February meeting, and I think it was more of an approach of anything you can give us, any type of support, and trying to identify that. The only other thing, as we had discussed before, was the possibility of providing 18 deltas on site, the possibility of us reviewing tactical plans. Those are the two that stand out for me, other than also what was requested.
Did you participate in that?
No, sir.
Okay, so they asked, but you declined because it was outside the scope of your operations order?
By the time I received General Pickler's order, and also by the time I had also already issued my own order to the personnel to go conduct the mission, we'd already determined by that point that we weren't going to get it near that.
Did you or any member of your team ever provide close quarters combat training to ATF in connection with the mission?
No, sir.
Are you familiar with whether they did have any of the training on close quarters combat?
Sir, to be honest, this had come up in answering some of the staffers' questions, and of course for almost 2 years now it's been a continuous question. And it's also been related in the Soldier of Fortune magazine. At no time did any of my personnel give any close quarters combat training, nor did myself. There's also something here that the ATF SRTs didn't ask for it. I don't think they specifically wanted it. They certainly seemed to have the capability, or they were doing it on their own, something similar. It was never really a serious question from ATF for close quarters battle training.
All right, hold on just a second. Are you familiar with the MOUT?
Yes, sir.
And what's it stand for?
Military Operations on Urban Terrain.
And that's almost some of the easier form of combat, isn't it? It's
that's
would
combat.
You describe what that is?
Right. That would be that's the doctrinal U.S. Army term for combat in built-up areas, or urbanized areas, or semi-urbanized areas.
And with it be similar described as I don't know if you want to call it a dynamic entry, but you're going to break down the doors, throw a hand grenade, and kill anything that's moving. Is that correct?
That more typifies the general instruction that goes on for MOUT, yes, sir. Lead with a grenade.
Right, that's what your job is.
Yes, sir.
The Army, correct?
Right,
and
sir.
Close combat support, though, is laying down discriminating fields of fire, is it not?
Close combat support?
Right. Or close quarters combat support.
Oh, close quarters. In close quarters battle, yes, it's discriminative fire technique.
Discriminating fire technique.
Yes, sir.
Would you just, what is the difference in level of training between MOUT and close quarters combat training in time to do that?
Just simply, obviously, for the U.S. Army term for the type of operations where you use discriminative fire, using specialized personnel who were selected to perform this and specialized equipment to also perform this plus specialized ammunition is close quarters battle. The time frame for that is considerably more extensive than it would be to prepare, say, an infantry company for against their mission essential task list of combat and urban environment.
But for the Army, isn't it 2 months of training for close quarters combat support?
For close quarters battle, sir?
Battle support is 2 months in training to do that?
It is approximately 2 months, yes, sir. Just for the basic line, yes, sir.
All right. ATF wasn't even close.
Thank you very much, Mr. Boyer. Mr. Brewster?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Ambassador Holmes, I think my friend, Mr. Taylor, established the fact that it's certainly legal, the training that was done. Wasn't the only question of the methamphetamine lab who was going to pay? Didn't that open it up where they did not have to pay for that training?
Well, the issue of paying or not paying is related to the budget, which the Congress gives us every year.
I understand
to
that.
To support law enforcement agencies. And we support all kinds of agencies. Forest Service, taking down marijuana, support to Customs Service across the board, and that is funded.
And you should, and I agree with that.
Right.
Mr. Schumer, a moment ago, made the comment that even if there wasn't a methamphetamine lab, the fact that it was alleged didn't break any law, and you concurred with that.
Would that mean then that any federal agency could, if they chose, allege that you or I or anyone else has a methamphetamine lab with no impunity?
Well, it doesn't work that way. I mean, the requests for support that come in.
I'm not talking that context, but Schumer was talking about just the fact that there was a methamphetamine lab alleged and there was no methamphetamine lab didn't break any law. Does that then mean that
breaking any law as far as we're concerned, at the time the Defense Department, the Joint Task Force 6, acted on the basis of the information presented by the Operation Alliance?
Two or three of you have talked about precursor chemicals. What precursor chemicals were alleged to be there? Propylene glycol, or what would it be?
Sir, I'm not certain exactly which precursor chemicals were there. I know it was discussed in the context of the possibility of delivery of those kinds of chemicals much earlier than 1993, and the suspicion of precursor chemicals being on the scene, if indeed there was a methamphetamine lab there. So, but never this precise chemical was identified to me.
There's never an allegation of a particular chemical alleged to Major Petrie or anyone else.
The only time we heard when you started getting the conversation of precursor chemicals was during the description in the 2 February preliminary meeting at Operation Alliance. The ATF representative, when he was giving a brief background as to why they had targeted this organization, they had described that the UPS or shipping documents, they were keeping a track on that. And a great deal of
and there were precursors for amphetamine?
No, sir, not for amphetamine. All I heard was precursor, and this was but consistent with the production of illegal drugs.
I noticed, too, that you're all active duty, and it seems National Guard helicopters were used. Doesn't that require the governor's approval? And did the governor approve?
To the best of my knowledge, the that was approved by the government of the state of Texas.
So, to your knowledge, the governor of Texas, Governor Richards, approved it.
I do not know whether the governor personally approved it, but I believe it, from what I've been told, that at least at the level of the adjutant general, it was approved.
Okay. Colonel Lindley, I note looking through your notes here. It seemed that you were always concerned about if it met the criteria. Did you ever satisfy yourself that it did?
Sir, as I testified earlier, I was involved in this thing through the end of the day. I had a message from Captain Becker, who was the third group attorney, near the end of the evening that indicated that the mission had been pared down. And as I testified earlier, I believe that everything that occurred out there involving the military was done legally and properly.
Okay. One more question. Major Petrie, I know you were involved in the training aspect of it, and the SRTs are a well-trained group to start with. You testified that they thought there was a possibility of gunfire there, yet I hear people say that the ATF was outgunned, that many of them only had sidearms, 9mm semi-automatic pistols, I don't know, Beretta, S&W, whatever. As a Special Forces person, if you were entering that type of a conflict, would you be better armed than that?
Well, sir, as to whether the ATF strictly had pistols, I can tell you at Fort Hood, Texas, we observe pistols, we observed submachine guns, we observed AR-15s, and we observe a long gun or a, trying hard not to use the word sniper because it connotes with ours, but a long range type of weapon like that with optics.
And you would expect then that each of the personnel would probably be equipped with some combination of those, as opposed to just carrying a 9mm handgun.
Well, that's what we saw at Fort Hood, yes.
Thank you.
Mr. Shattuck, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Let me begin with a kind of a puzzling document that we have in this investigation. It's a document produced by the Treasury Department along with thousands of other documents, apparently from notes taken following the investigation, and it goes to this issue, so I want to read it. It says, quote,
And these are apparently notes taken down by the Treasury Department investigators following the incident. Unfortunately, they don't give us the source of this individual, and the way they produce these just in mass piles, it's impossible for us to identify the source. But it says, the use of the National Guard was a scam. In my opinion, .. to my knowledge, period. There was never any mention of a meth lab being on the compound, .. This was a scam initiated by Bureau headquarters. I assume that's Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms. Again, in my opinion, to obtain the additional resources of the National Guard, air support assistance, etc. That's troubling to me.
Do we have copies of the document he was reading?
I believe you have copies of all these documents. It contains a base stamp of 00010228.
Record, those would be documents that have been produced to both sides for the purposes of the committee by the department. So I don't have it up here recopied, but you've got them somewhere.
I think the drug nexus issue is one of concern. It's of great concern to me to consider that perhaps one agency of the federal government lied to another agency of the federal government to procure the resources, even if they could have procured similar resources by some other means. Now, General Pickler, as I understand your testimony, they would not have gotten your resources but for the drug nexus. Is that right?
That's correct, sir.
And I believe Major Petrie made the exact same point. Is that not correct, Major?
That's correct, sir. He wouldn't have given me the mission to do it.
Okay. General Pickler, I want to ask you about a document that I've handed to you. It's dated 9 September 93. It says to SOJ3 from SOJA. Do you have that document?
Yes, sir, I do.
Can you tell me who that really is to and from in layman's
language? No, sir,
I
cannot. That is not part of my organization. So I guess it's Special Operations Command, but I'm not sure, sir.
Okay.
And I've not seen that document before.
Do any of you recognize that document? Could you pass it up and down?
Sure, I do. That's USOCOM at MacDill Air Force Base. The SOJ-3 is the operations office within USOCOM. And I think the SOJ-8, if I'm not mistaken, I could be, is the budget office, but I could be mistaken.
Well, if one of you would go to that document and go to the paragraph number 3, it says in that paragraph, the third sentence, in that instance, referring to the Waco investigation and the Waco siege, we, and that's why I want to know who the author of the document was, were persuaded to provide BATF free training with the allegation, never confirmed, proven, or even acknowledged that it was for a, quote, suspected methamphetamine laboratory, close quote. I take it would be a concern to each of you if you were persuaded to use your resources based on a representation of a methamphetamine lab when no such lab existed, nor was there really reasonable evidence that such a lab did exist, wouldn't it?
It would be a concern, Mr. Congressman, but I had absolutely no reason to doubt it at the time.
You were relying on what you were being told?
I was relying on what I was being told and what was in writing to us at JTF-6 through the vetted organization of Operation Alliance.
Boy, if you can't rely on what another agency of the federal government tells you, you're in trouble. Mr. Moreland, let me ask you a question. I believe, Staff Sergeant Moreland, you said that you were not present at the time of this proceeding. Were you ever asked to get your act together with your testimony or the events involved in this particular incident to discuss how all these things came down and to kind of get your story together?
No, sir. Again, I was not there no, sir.
A colleague of yours from Fort Bragg contacted us and indicated that you had said at one point that there were some individuals at the raid. Are you familiar with who that might be, how we might track that individual down?
No, sir, I would not.
Okay. No idea where that kind of information might come from?
No, sir.
This seems to me to be a unique opportunity for you to tell the American people about what went on at this incident. Why don't you tell us in your words?
As far as how the training went and things like that?
Your role, what you think went correct, what you think went wrong.
With the actual mission itself, the actual...
With either the military's role in it or BATF's?
I wouldn't like to critique ATF's role, because I'm not a law enforcement officer, I don't have that kind of experience, so it would be an uneducated guess. So for me to say what ATF did right or what they did wrong would not help anything.
Okay, what about the military's role? Were you concerned the military was being asked to play a role that, on the basis of information that was not in fact accurate, is that a concern to you?
No, sir.
Thank you very much.
Sir, I'd like to clarify the memorandum. The SOJ-3 is, in fact, the operations office. And I had thought that you had said SOJ-8, and, in fact, the SOJA is the judge advocate's office for U.S. SOCOM.
So again, for the larger audience out there, it's the lawyers, the judge advocates.
That's correct.
Communicating with the operations people.
Absolutely.
About this concern of theirs with regard to the allegation of a meth lab.
That is a fact.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Shadegg. Mr. Watt? You're recognized for 5 minutes. Oh, if Mr. Lantos is next. I'm sorry, I didn't see you there, Mr. Lantos. Then you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I want to commend this panel for outstanding and professional set of responses that I was privileged to watch from my office. I'd like to go beyond the sphere of questioning that you have had so far. The purpose of a congressional hearing is really twofold. One is to find out what happened. And the second is to look to the possible need for additional legislation to accommodate new circumstances. Now, I raised the question with an earlier panel with respect to the dramatically changing threat environment to the United States, both in terms of terrorism, nuclear smuggling, biological, chemical weapons, other items. I would be very grateful, Ambassador Holmes and any other member of the panel, if you would step beyond Waco for a moment and from your posture of experience of dealing with these issues and dealing with the changing threat to the United States, the World Trade Center bombing, the episode in Tokyo of a violent religious cult pumping poison gas into a subway system, other matters. Do you feel that your involvement needs to be redefined, broadened, brought up to date? Because it's very interesting to deal with the minutiae of the Waco episode, which I think is very critical at the micro level. But there is a macro level, and the macro level is the threat to the United States in this new environment with both governmental terrorism, individual terrorism, violent cults. And since you are the entity that is clearly the best equipped, best prepared, best funded in the United States, would you care to give us your thinking as to the new ground rules that perhaps might be needed? Ambassador Holmes, will you begin?
Congressman, you've raised a very important point in my view. Certainly with the World Trade Center attack, unhappily, this announced the arrival of terrorism in the United States.
Exactly.
I happen to be the official in the Defense Department responsible for combating terrorism.
I know.
I have worked, all of us have worked very hard since the beginning of the administration to pick up on the very good work done by the Bush administration to expand our procedures, particularly in light of the phenomenon of the weapons of mass destruction and the possibility after the end of the Cold War that these kinds of weapons could fall into the hands of terrorists. We have done a lot of work. We've made a lot of progress, not only within the Defense Department, but interagency, working with our colleagues who have the lead agency responsibility overseas. It's the State Department. Within the United States, it's the Justice Department, particularly the FBI. I think we have the authority we need. We have the funding. We're working on sharpening our procedures, conducting exercises, and we've had very strong support from the President in this regard.
Would any of your colleagues on the panel care to comment? Go ahead. Yes.
Sir, from my perspective and work both as the commander of Joint Task Force 6 and the director of operations for U.S. Army Forces Command, where we were intimately involved in military support to civilian authorities, I believe that our current policies in dealing with that, coupled with the laws and regulations, particularly the political the constraints of posse comitatus, are appropriate for the use of military forces in the context of today's environment. And I believe the history and tradition on which they are based are as solid today as they have been in the past. And my own view is that the emphasis in that regard properly applied to civilian law enforcement agencies for their unique kind of work, different from the military type of work, is appropriate to combat some of that threat, sir.
Would any other member of the panel care to comment? I take it, therefore, none of you feel any need for additional legislation. You feel that the current laws provide the flexibility even in this very new and changed threat environment to dealing with the issues. Mr. Ambassador.
That is clearly my view with respect not only to countering terrorism, but also to combating illegal narcotics.
And in retrospect, what specific steps should have been or should have been taken by civilian authorities, civilian law enforcement agencies, in bringing you in more effectively?
With respect to which problem?
Waco.
I believe that the system worked as it has been set up, and as has been well explained during this hearing by General Pickler and others, that when the Operation Alliance, representing the civilian law enforcement agencies, came with a request that was specific, and I think that the JTF-6 had all the authority it required to respond to that, and in fact that is what happened.
So from the point of view of the Department of Defense, the post-mortem reveals nothing that's gone wrong?
From our standpoint, everything that was done by the Department of Defense was completely according to law and to the delegated authority of the officials concerned.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Shabbat, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I've heard four or five times today the question or comment that whatever the facts were, that didn't give Koresh and his followers the right to open fire on federal officers, resulting in the deaths of four officers. That seems to be the spin of the day on the other side of the aisle. I don't think it should come as any surprise that myself and all of my colleagues agree with the folks on the other side of the aisle. There was absolutely no excuse for the killing of these officers. We are attempting to get all the facts out in this particular case so that we can avoid this type of tragedy in the future. Now, let me shift gears here. At the close of the hearing last night, we heard testimony from Agent Aguilera that, contrary to government testimony given earlier in the day, ATF agents in the helicopters were not informed of any rule requiring them to unload their weapons while they were on the helicopters. Mr. Aguilera's testimony on this point is especially important since he was on the helicopter during the raid. Mr. Aguilera further testified that the rules of the operation did permit agents in the helicopters to return fire from the compound if they received it. I'd like to return to the question of the helicopters with this panel. The Treasury Department has insisted that the helicopters were used solely as a distraction and not for any aerial assault. That may well have been the plan, but Treasury documents reveal that at one point at least, the idea of a helicopter assault
was discussed, as was the idea of a so-called nighttime ninja assault. The idea of a helicopter assault was then dismissed, apparently, but one agent went so far as to draft a letter to the Customs Air Branch in Houston requesting that they provide helicopters for an aerial assault. Prior to my question, Mr. Chairman, I'd ask unanimous consent to introduce two Treasury documents referring to the helicopter air assault plan that was later ruled out in favor of a plan in which helicopters would mainly be used as a diversion.
Without objection, so received.
Thank you. My concern is prompted not only by the initial consideration of an air assault and how an air assault would help to serve a search warrant, I don't know, but also by the testimony last night of Mr. Aguilera. And now I find that there's yet another document, handwritten notes of some reviewing official that say, and I quote, HCs, which means helicopters, as a diversion, simultaneous gunfire, worked in Seattle, 300 to 400 meters from boundary, hover, and then it says practiced at Hood, which I assume refers to Fort Hood. So my first question to you gentlemen is this. Did any of you hear or participate in any discussion about any plan, proposed plan, or contingent plan to use helicopters for an air assault on the Branch Davidian compound in the initial raid?
Sir, at my level in JTF-6, I did not.
Sir, at our level, we did. One of the missions of the detachment was to facilitate the helicopters actually entering into military airspace and then entering military airspace over what was essentially a rather large area for range operations in terms of live bullets. In describing what they wanted to do with it, we had to get the tech with how they wanted to employ the helicopters. I was involved in this discussion in order to get the right clearance and coordinate that through the radio to range control so that we could correctly relay the intent. During that time period, they mentioned the phrase, we're going to use this as a distraction. Everything else, though, I don't remember hearing. I didn't hear.
Okay, there's another document that I'd like to have passed out there at this time, if I could. I'd just like to refer to a couple of terms in here. They use the term helicopters as a diversion. It says simultaneous gunfire. Would that have any meaning? This is a document that we've all received. In going through these documents, you find a lot of information. This is one of the things that we discovered, and we thought it would be an appropriate question to ask here. Helicopters as a diversion, simultaneous gunfire. Or worked in Seattle. Is there another incident in Seattle that would be relevant to the hearings that we have today?
Those being asked a question preceding this one answered in the negative.
Negative, sir. I'm not aware of any operation in Seattle or any reference to an operation in Seattle. That's clearly outside the JTF-6 area of operations anyway.
Okay. Do you know if the Hood referred to there is Fort Hood in all likelihood?
Sure. Again, I can testify to that they did practice and state that they were practicing and using the helicopters as a diversion method. We can testify to that at Hood.
Let me ask you this. In any of the discussions that were had and any of the training that occurred down at Fort Hood, did the ATF ever indicate whether they contemplated that this raid would in all likelihood result in civilian casualties?
Contemplate? Yes.
Was likely to result in civilian casualties or casualties to the members of the ATF themselves?
I never got a feeling for what they determined to be their likelihood or the likelihood or what sort of percentage of possibility. I didn't get any of that kind of indication from them. I just know that in the medical support planning that we had discussed, we needed to consider that to develop some of the classes and then also in some of the assistance we provided in laying on the medical support.
My time is about that. One final question. Did they consider this? Were they aware that this was a high-risk operation?
by high risk, I mean likely to take casualties on either side?
I can only answer as to what I saw in terms of what they were planning and what assistance they asked us for around that area in terms of medevac planning.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I don't think you can answer further. Mr. Watt?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to address a question to Ambassador Holmes, General Huffman, and Colonel Lindley in particular. There are some of the members of this these two committees who think that these hearings are a massive waste of taxpayer money and designed for a political objective rather than a legislative objective. And I was happy to see that Mr. Lantos at least started to talk about the notion of having some legislative connection as opposed to a lot of the witch hunt that we have been on during the course of these hearings. My specific question is, I take it that your connection with this is that you provided military support or involvement of to some extent, and some people have questioned whether that stepped across the line in some way to get you into law enforcement as opposed to military conduct. Is there any one of you three gentlemen who I think are lawyers and assistant secretaries who believe that you in any way stepped across a legal line that the military should not have stepped across in this episode in any way?
Absolutely not.
Mr. Lindley and Mr. Huffman?
No, Congressman, I do not.
Would you say the, Mr. Lindley, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to.
Sir, absolutely not, sir.
Would the three of you say that the guidelines which basically define what those limits are between the military and the and law enforcement worked as they were designed to work in this particular case?
I think the guidelines are clear and they worked. Based on my examination of the record, of course, I was not in the Defense Department at the time.
Mr. Huffman?
I was not a personal participant either, but based on my review, everything worked the way it was supposed to work.
It worked as it was supposed to work, sir.
Does either one of the three of you think that there is any kind of legislative response that this committee, these two committees, or that the Congress of the United States should be making to further clarify the line that between the military and law enforcement to address any abuses that took place in this process?
I have no suggestions in that regard. I think the guidelines are very clear.
General Huffman?
I have no suggestions.
No suggestions, sir.
Thank you. I would just have some question about whether these witnesses have any knowledge of these documents, just as they didn't seem to have any knowledge of the documents that Mr. Shabbat was introducing. But I would submit for the record the statements of a number of individuals who were actually on the helicopter who deny that they fired at any point.
Without objection, so admitted.
And I'll yield back the balance of my time.
Thank you very much, Mr. Watt. Mr. Blut, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. At this time, I would yield my 5 minutes to Chairman Zeloff.
Okay. Okay. And I'll yield to Mr. Shabbat.
Thank you. I'll try not to use up all the time here. I appreciate that, Mr. Chairman. Just a couple of follow-up questions to Major Petrie here. I've got a document that I'd like to have delivered to you at this particular moment in light of the your testimony about casualties. It's a document at the top. It says scenario, and the right-hand corner it says D1159, meaning we got this from the Defense Department. I'd like to bring your attention down to item number 6 and number 7. Item number 6 says DLEA recognizes that casualties are probable. Item number 7 says casualties will be DLEA, bad guys and civilians. And I'm just wondering, have you ever seen this document before?
No, sir, I've never seen it.
Clear up something.
That was going to be my next question, is does anyone else at the table aware of this particular item?
I am the author of this, sir. Okay. What happened in this situation, approximately 2 weeks after we became aware that the mission 002 Echo had in fact been the Waco operation, I was tasked by the staff judge advocate at Special Forces Command to conduct a continuing legal education seminar for our group attorneys for other Special Forces groups that would be rotating through JTF-6. I have taken liberties with the situation to use this as a training event for the attorneys within Special Forces Command. This was part of a teleconference that went out. It's true that I used the rough fact basis that occurred out at Waco, Texas, but I elaborated on that a little bit for professional development with my attorneys and to engage in a discussion back and forth in the area of statutory interpretation and development.
Let me ask another question here. Major Petrie, it's my understanding that you were at a meeting, I believe February 1st of 93, and at that meeting there were casualties discussed at that meeting. Is that potential casualties at the Operation Alliance?
At Op Alliance, and I think the date was 2 February. I may have given the staffers a wrong date.
They gave me February 1st, but if it's 2nd or 1st, I think
first
that's
or
fine.
Second,
doesn't
sir.
Matter too much.
Once again, it was at that time, it was put to us and couched in the terms of eventuality, or not eventuality, but the possibility. It was in case of...
Go ahead.
It was couched to us in terms of in case of casualties.
Sure, I might add. What type of casualties were we talking about, though, Floyd?
Well, I think at that point it was not so much whether it was LEA or whether it was so much residents or somebody with a weapon. It was put to us, or as we understood it, we were discussing types of wounds and we were discussing age groups.
Right. I'm not trying to get tricky here, right?
Yes,
we're not talking about auto accidents and things. We were talking about potential gunshot wounds, I would assume.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Who raised the issue? Did ATF raise the issue, or did the military raise the issue? Or
at the two, I would describe the 2 February meeting, and I've used this phrase before, as essentially a horse blanket, because I think it was at that point a search on their part as to what support the military could provide. And as they were going down a long list of things, they came across medical support, and that was both on-site, planning for, coordinating for, possible equipment to support it, in terms of both medevac and emergency trauma treatment.
Thank you. Officer Fitz, if I could just ask you a question. It's my understanding that you taught the ATF members proper ways to carry the casualties, et cetera. Is that right?
We discussed it, yes, sir.
I'm sorry, I couldn't hear you.
We discussed it. We never actually went through hands-on, but it was discussed, the proper way to transport.
What was discussed?
Just the proper carries and then way to carry the casualties from the site back to the first level care.
And what type of casualties are we referring to here in all likelihood?
Gunshot wound casualties, sir.
Okay. And did you,
it's my understanding that you actually contacted a local ambulance company about this matter to be on standby or to give additional assistance if it were necessary?
Yes, sir, I contacted an ambulance company to find out the availability of having an ambulance on site during the day of the...
And I assume that that's because that it was very possible that there might be fairly heavy casualties in this action.
Sir, when you're planning medical evacuation, you plan for worst-case scenario at all times.
Right. And it wasn't the worst-case scenario that happened here necessarily, but it was a pretty bad scenario. I think my time's up.
Yeah, Mr. Chabot, I was going to say your time is up. Thank you. Ms. Lofgren, I believe you were passed earlier. Would you like to five minutes?
Mr. Chairman, I'm sorry. Before you return to Ms. Lofgren, I wonder, since Colonel Lindley has identified the document that was referred to, I'd ask unanimous consent be made part of the record.
Without objection.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Ms. Lofgren, would you like to take up your 5 minutes?
Yeah, I don't think I'll take my whole 5 minutes, as most of my questions have been asked and answered. Really just following up, in a sense, on my colleague from California's question earlier about the role of the military forces in our country and civilian disorder in the future as the world becomes more complicated. I think one of the things that has kept our country strong and safe, and every military person I've ever met agrees, is the civilian control of the armed forces in separation of the military from civilian patrol of law enforcement. And I know that the Posse Comitatus law does maintain that distinction between patrol and the like. And yet, as I've listened to the detailed collaborative efforts that were made that were clearly consistent with what the law requires, it occurs to me to what extent you all were invited to suggest alternatives to the plan that you were asked to collaborate on or train for or prepare for. Earlier to the panel preceding you, I asked whether, given the fact situation, as I think any reasonable person would have known it by the time of the final day in April, we were dealing with a cult figure who had pretty obviously beaten babies and raped children and was in charge and had controlled the will of people, and whether or not an armed assault was likeliest to resolve the situation. I think it was engaged in good faith, but obviously it didn't work. And whether you were asked for advice on alternative plans, given the vast resources the military has in the psychological fields and the like, and probably greater than what is available to civilian authorities. And if you were not asked that, do you think that is a proper training role for the military to consider in the future? General Huffman, do you have a comment, or whoever has a comment on that, I would appreciate.
I have no knowledge that the military was asked for any alternative plans. I certainly do not know whether the military advised on any alternative plans. As has been pointed out, this was a civilian law enforcement agency operation. They have the expertise. They ask us for specific support under the law, which we provided. Yes,
ma'am. Ambassador Holmes, do you think, given that this was a training and a resource inquiry in the future, do you think it would be inappropriate to include the larger resources of the armed forces in terms of psychological understanding? I understand there's some depth in our armed forces in that field, and to deal with a cult situation such as this in the future? Or do you think that would cross that line that none of us want to cross in America?
I don't think it would necessarily cross the line, but I feel it important to just say before this committee that, just to remind everybody the obvious, that the primary role of the armed forces of the United States is to fight and win our nation's battles. And where we can provide support to civil authorities across a range of activities, which we've been doing for many years, we will always try to do that and play our part. But we're not looking for additional roles.
No, I understand that, and I'm a newcomer to the Congress, but I've just been reviewing some of the things that Congress has asked you to do in the last number of years. Get involved in drug interdiction, get involved in certain other consultative, you know, it's not coming from you, but the Congress is asking the military to be a resource, and frankly, the terrorism bill that's on its way to the floor expands that role to some extent. So these are things.
Well, that's an important bill for the administration, obviously.
Does anyone else on the panel have a comment? If not, then, Mr. Chair, I yield back what's left of my
Thank you time. Very much, Ms. Lofgren. Mr. Micah?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I know we have a vote pending, but I wanted to take just a minute or two. First of all, I want to commend all of you that serve in the military and apologize in a way that you have to be here, but this is the way the system works, and it's really kind of a neat system to see it work because of all the protections that are built in. And that's really the reason for this hearing is, you know, you heard earlier some of the members testified that from the very beginning our Americans have been concerned about the military becoming involved in civilian law enforcement. The only instance I understand that you can become involved is when there's a drug case, and we've set some parameters from that. Is that correct, Ambassador, pretty much? Except in disasters and things like that.
No, I was going to say, it really isn't. I mean, there is a wide panoply of activities established under law for support, and they can be anything from man-made to natural disasters to emergencies.
Exactly, but in this particular instance, the pretense on which you went into this Waco situation was under a drug...
That legislation began in 1989,
right,
and that is under the counter-drug support
but
legislation.
The thing that disturbs me, and you know, we had the sheriff sitting at the other end, or deputy sheriff, and he said there'd been no evidence of a drug lab there for some time. Don't you all feel a little bit sort of duped by the information that you were given? Now, I don't want to say anyone here acted improperly, because you all did, and you followed a chain of command. But now that it's taken place, it doesn't appear that there was that threat.
Well, based on my secondhand knowledge of the situation, I have to say that our people have to react to the situation and to the circumstances at the time. And at the time, they did receive advice from Operation Alliance based on the...
They took orders and they did
no,
what
it was...
They
took a request.
Right. Well, let me ask you about the request, if I may, for just a second. You said, you know, you have this alliance or council that makes the decision.
Operation Alliance.
Is this a committee decision, or is there a military or civilian person that really signs on the dotted line? I kept hearing saying, well, Washington approved or the alliance approved. Is it the military? Who makes that decision? Who is the?
I would ask General Pickler to answer
that
question.
Could you tell me? I don't know. I really want to find out.
Sir, there's a comprehensive process, as you might expect, for the receipt and processing of support requests for military.
Sir, who signs who is the ultimate signator to that? I mean, are there many signatures if I look at, or are there many people that sign off?
There should be an audit trail of signatures, but requests can also come into Operation Alliance on a verbal nature. But when we receive the request from Operation Alliance, the Military Support Working Group, which consists of four primary representatives from Operation Alliance, it's headed by one of the principal top-level law enforcement agents, that is DEA Customs or Border Patrol, heads up the Military Support Working Group. There is another federal agent in that working group. There is a state work agent, and there is a local agent.
There's no one then we can pinpoint like a single responsibility. Everyone signing off.
Sir, I have that support request from that particular operation was signed off from Operation Alliance by a member of the organization.
Was he military or civilian?
Civilian, sir.
Okay. And see, what I'm trying to get at is the procedure correct? Are we doing things? Is somebody looking at this? God forbid we should have aid. There were women and children here, totally innocent, and four agents who were killed. And our intent is to see that that doesn't happen again. So I appreciate, again, I appreciate what you all have done. You've been put in a terrible predicament, but the process in the system is, and the reason we're here today is to make sure it doesn't happen again and to construct it so that we have those protections in. And I thank you, and I yield back to the chairman. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much, Mr. Mike. I think we're about at the point of a vote at this juncture, and most of your time had expired at that time. I have a couple of questions I think I'll get to ask later on down the road, but thank you for yielding. I am going to recess this hearing, but we're going to have a vote. I understand there are going to be four votes, one 15-minute vote followed by three, I believe, other 5-minute votes. So I would suggest that we're going to have a break of at least 30 minutes here, maybe a little longer, but the witnesses should know that. We'll get back as quickly as we can, and I ask the members to be back within 5 minutes of the conclusion of the final vote. Ambassador Holmes, yes.
Mr. Ambassador. I just wonder how, if the chairman could give us some indication of how long we'll be here. I'm supposed to be going to Special Operations Command for an important strategic conference this evening.
I can understand that. I had to believe that we probably wouldn't have more than 30 minutes more, roughly, when we get back. I would guess that you're talking, though, because of these votes not getting out of here before 6. And if that presents a major problem, we can discuss
it. If we can get out by 6, I can make my point. Thank you.
We'll do our best. Thank you. This hearing's in recess.
Okay, we're going to have to.
I guess I didn't say the magic words. Hearing's in recess.
We'll continue with this hearing in a few minutes. First, some programming information.
Sunday night on Road to the White House, Republican Senator Phil Graham.
If I'm elected president, I'm going to balance the federal budget or die politically trying. I don't think we can go on this spending spree, and I think America is ready for a president who will say no when no is the right answer, and no is often the right answer in Washington, D.C.
Road to the White House, Sunday night at 7 and 10 Eastern and Pacific Time on C-SPAN, the political network of record.
We now continue with the House Joint Subcommittee hearing on federal actions at Waco, Texas in the spring of 1993. This was the second day of 8 scheduled days of hearings.
Hearing of the joint subcommittees will come to order. When we had our recess a few moments ago, we were in the process of completing questions of this panel of the military relative to their knowledge of the Waco incident. And I believe at this point in time, we are ready to ask if Mr. Heineman has a question or two. You have 5 minutes if you'd like, Mr. Heineman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. At this time, I'd like to yield my time to the gentleman from Tennessee, Mr. Bryant.
I thank my colleague, a lifetime career law enforcement officer from New York and North Carolina, presently serving the Congress out of North Carolina, for yielding time to me. Let me ask Major Petrie, if I could, are you familiar with the term, and is it a military term that you're used to using, dynamic entry?
No, sir.
It's not a military term?
No, sir, it's not.
And are you familiar with it now?
Yes, sir, now.
As a result of these hearings?
Yes, sir.
What do you understand that? Have you heard about that through the ATF or anything?
I don't recall, or I don't remember hearing the phrase dynamic entry through ATF.
Okay.
This is the first time I've heard of it, really.
All right. I met most of you during the break, and I want to add my congratulations and commendation to all of you, especially some of you that may not be as familiar with testifying before a congressional committee as your superiors are. Y'all are all holding yourselves very accountable, and I appreciate that very much. You're a fine example of our new volunteer army, and you've all obviously progressed a great deal in the military. I wanted to ask, because I was out just briefly during part of the testimony of Staff Sergeant Fitz, I understand you're trained, your MOS is a paramedic?
Close to the equivalent of a paramedic, yes, sir.
Okay, and I'm going to ask you if you would to even pull that a little bit closer and lean over. You have medical training, and as a part of this process, your dealings with the ATF, I understand you were assigned to draft up a plan under the contingency that there would be a raid and perhaps there was methamphetamine lab in there, and what should occur in case there was an accident?
Excuse me. My planning for the ATF did not include methamphetamine lab. It was just for the day's events to establish some sort of network to get the wounded out of the area and back to a higher treatment facility as quick as possible.
Okay, as I understand, you were tasked with that job by your superior officer to draw up a contingency plan from the medical standpoint, because there is a higher risk of danger, is there not, to raiding, if you will, using a dynamic entry into a facility that has an methamphetamine laboratory in it?
Yes, sir.
Kind of a long question, but you understand. And the risk are associated with if there were a bullet shot into it or some type of cause of it to explode, it could be a danger, especially to children, to older people, to people around it?
I think there'd be an equal danger to all people, regardless of age.
Okay. And you did draft up this plan of evacuation, medical treatment, or whatever. And as I understand, you presented it to certain ATF people at a meeting.
So the thing that we presented at the meeting in Houston was a research paper that I had done previous to that about the dangers and cautions a detachment, a special forces detachment, should take if they encounter a methamphetamine lab. The setting up the medical evacuation network was done after the Houston meeting, and that concerned mainly just getting points of contact and giving them my advice what I felt they needed as far as the medical evacuation net concerned.
So the paper that you gave to the agents with ATF concerned the dangers that we've talked about already?
Yes, sir, concerned the dangers.
And then I understand you had a subsequent meeting on the heels of this meeting in which there was never a discussion during that meeting, and as far as you were concerned, it was never discussed again in terms of that laboratory.
So the meeting was over a two-day period in Houston. I consider it was one meeting, and then no, I never again discussed the methamphetamine lab with any of the agents.
And I guess my question was, did you ever hear the agents, the ATF agents, talk to you about the lab being there anymore? I got the impression that basically you understood that subject just dropped off the earth.
That was my impression, sir, but as I stated earlier, I was trying to do research with a book they had listing the people inside the compound so I would know what kind of medical evacuation, extra extraordinary measures that might be needed at the site when the raid, for better lack of term, went down.
I think that's fair enough. Y'all were not here yesterday when I expressed my concerns, much as many on this side have, that no one here is condoning what went on at Waco in terms of Mr. Koresh and how he responded to this. It was totally irresponsible in terms of firing back at these agents. That should not have occurred. He should not have abused these children if that's what he did, and I assume he did. We've got testimony there. But on the other hand, there were mistakes made on the other side. There were 20 other children that died as a result of the second dynamic raid on that. And as Congress, we have oversight. It's our job to oversee these federal agents and make sure that what was done was proper. If there was error, if there was mistake, that we correct that so that we don't have another Waco. And that's the intent of this hearing, and I think we're making some good progress on that. And I want to commend each one of you for your testimony, and thank you for making your appearance today. You've added a great deal to this hearing. I would yield back the balance of...
Mr. Bryant, your time has expired, or Mr. Heineman says in this case. Mr. Barr, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'd like to yield my time to the gentleman, Chairman Nazelov.
Thank you, Mr. Barr. General Pickler, I just one quick question. I overheard you say something about verbal approvals. Is that the case, or did I misunderstand in terms of some request for military assets?
No, sir, I did not say verbal approvals. I believe I intended to say that there were verbal requests and discussions of missions
that took place, but...
But not verbal approvals.
Not verbal approvals, no,
sir. Just made me feel a lot better about the process. Ambassador Holmes, did you ever receive any funding from the drug and addiction effort relative to Waco, the use of military assets at Waco, in terms of in-addiction money?
No, to the best of my knowledge. I wasn't on board at the time, but I have no knowledge of that.
General, anything is, I guess my real question is, did any drug and addiction monies get used? Did any assets get charged off the drug and addiction effort for the assets that were used at Waco? That you know of? If not, if you could get back to us.
The JTF-6 actions were all limited to general support training in the mobile training team context that you've heard testified before, all prior to the events of 28 February. From a JTF-6 perspective, I know of no counter-drug monies that were devoted to that other than the ones that have been described in the context of JTF-6 support by the Rapid Support Unit, sir.
Thank you. Were there, in your knowledge, any foreign nationals, military personnel on the scene at Waco?
I have no knowledge of that.
Okay. If that should change, if you'd let us know, we would appreciate it. Ambassador Holmes, the Secretary of Defense has indicated on May 17, 1995 memorandum, the current system to provide DOD assistance to law enforcement agencies is encumbered by conflicting directives, multiple entry points, and diverse funding authorities. The clerk will pass out document 6. Were there any problems with the loaning of DOD equipment during the Waco incident?
I'm not aware of any problems in either phase one or phase two.
Okay. Well, the clerk should also pass out document number 5, and that is a message from the Commander of Army Material Command dated March 11, 1993. Relevant part says it now appears that the military has loaned equipment without the approval of the Pentagon. Yesterday, the Pentagon and the White House were severely embarrassed because they heard the news first from CNN. I guess we all find that out once in a while. If queried by any agency, federal or otherwise, for assistance on any type in connection with the Waco, Texas operation, you need to request approval from this headquarters. We will then coordinate with the Pentagon. And apparently there's also a document number 4, which is a handwritten note, and it's been redacted. But there are some questions as to what the ground rules were or what our involvement was. I guess I'll just open an open comment. Anything that you care to comment on any of those documents?
Well, the only document that I'm very familiar with is 6A, which is the document signed by Secretary Perry on military support to civil authorities, and the attached document signed by my immediate boss, Undersecretary Walt Slocum, which basically assigns me the responsibility for conducting a review ordered by Secretary Perry.
Okay, thank you. Just my last question here, and on the amount of assets that were used at Waco included 2 UH-1 helicopters, 10 M2A1 Bradleys, 2 main battle tanks, Abrams, 2 HMMWVs, and 3 CH-47s and 3 UH-1 helicopters on standby. In addition, the Texas Army National Guard support included 10 Bradley fighting vehicles, 5 combat engineer vehicles, and 12 HMMWVs. I just would like to say that on September 14, 1993, General Montgomery requested only 4 Abrams and 14 Bradleys for support of troops in Somalia, and the tragic end of that request was no, and we gave more military hardware to Waco than we did to support and could have prevented perhaps those 18 deaths, which were tragic. I don't necessarily expect a comment except anything that you would add to it. It just seems that it's a tragedy that the decision making,
I have no comment.
Thank you very much.
Time it up. Mr. Zeloff. Mr. Taylor is asking if you yield, but his time is up, Mr. Taylor. He does not have time to yield. Mr. Sauter?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I, too, want to thank all of you for coming. I've always been proud of my Uncle Bud, who is a Green Beret 8th Team Special Forces, and I'm really proud that you're there to defend our liberty. I think part of the problem with this is it's very scary to see all of you at a panel on a domestic issue, because that's one of the things that we're very concerned about in founding of our country, because you're our best and brightest fighters and our special forces, and that's partly why we're doing this examination, not to critique you so much as to say were you used properly. And one of the concerns that I have, and I've been getting all kinds of calls in my office, people handing me things, and it's very difficult to verify what things are true and what things aren't true. But I wanted to ask Mr. Moreland a very specific question, and I'm sorry I can't verify, and I want to ask you personally. Under oath, did you recently say to a fellow member of the Army something to this effect, "I don't care, I'm getting out of the Army anyway. When I go up there and they put me under oath, I'm going to tell everything that went wrong"?
No, sir, not to my knowledge. No.
Thank you,
no.
And I assume that that's actually an honest answer, and I'm sorry that I put you to that, but we get these in, and I wanted to ask you the question, and I appreciate your honesty in the answer. I yield the rest of my time to Mr. Schiff.
Thank you, gentlemen, for yielding. Colonel Lindley, I'd like to go back to this scenario that you drew up, and I understand it was for future training, but one of the premises here is that the domestic law enforcement agency want to take down a lab, meaning a methamphetamine lab. Is that the premise of the Waco mission as you understood it?
Yes, sir. In fact, that was the only issue of the methamphetamine lab. The guns came up later.
The guns came up later?
Yes, sir.
Right. I'm sorry for that. I just wanted to say that I think that shows one smoking gun here at least, and I can assure everyone I'm making no pun in that. We have the fact that although no law may have been violated, the fact is that the Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms Department were in so much of a hurry to get military support that they knew that they were not going to get some military support, at least from Joint Task Force 6, unless there was a drug connection. What they did was create the drug connection, because without the drug connection, there would have been no military support for their operation. I think we've established that through these two panels. I think taking it further for just a second here, we can add to that, that if you add other factors, you show that the Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms Department could not wait to hold a military-style raid, that was their goal at a certain point and nothing could dissuade them. We have the fact just established, I think, that they misrepresented the mission as a drug mission to get the military support from the Joint Task Force. Second, that they made no effort to arrest David Koresh outside of the compound, which, by the way, would have provided the best opportunity to save the children inside the compound, which we started hearing in these panels became a major thought in this raid. Well, of course, that wasn't their major intention. Their major intention was a firearms violation. That's what the arrest warrant and the search warrant say. They turned down the offer made by David Koresh to come into the compound and look around, which they should have done even if they weren't going to find any illegal firearms, just to look at the inside of the premises. Their preparation was so poor that their surveillance team was spotted because a bunch of 40-year-olds in expensive cars don't look like college students. They went ahead when surprise was lost. They were rushing to get the media there because the tip to the mailman, who was a Koresh supporter, was from a news truck that was looking for the Waco site. And it was only ATF who could have told the news media to be there. I think you put all this together, it shows exactly like what Mr. Morrison of the Los Angeles Police Department essentially said, that poor management by the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms put their own agents into an unconscionably dangerous situation. With that, Mr. Chairman, I yield to you any remaining time.
Thank you very much for yielding. I wanted to ask one question of you, General Pickler. With respect to JTF-6, am I understanding correct from the very beginning of these hearings, and I think this is an important point to be made, that if it were not for the drug connection, your particular unit, JTF-6, would not have been, under the rules of the Army or your rules, been permitted to be training ATF as they did before the Waco raid. Am I correct? That's what you said to us early on in this process?
Yes, sir, I did say that. If it were not for some kind of drug connection, we would not have been participant, or we would have not have trained the agents in
this
process.
Yes, Mr. Taylor.
Mr. Chairman, that seems to contradict the answer that I received when I asked if a local law enforcement agency were to ask them with some help and training into how to best storm a building that they suspected was heavily armed. The answer was, yes, we would provide that.
Well, I think we'll get that clarified.
Without a drug connection. Is that not also correct? And don't they tend to contradict each other?
The answer that was given, I believe, by the DOD representative was that there is support that can be provided. And in the context of this particular mission, if it had come to our attention that there was no drug connection, we would have referred that support properly to the Department of Defense for their consideration of support.
But this particular unit was not under the rules of the Army or DOD permitted to give training to anybody that didn't have a drug support connection like this. Is that right? I mean, that's what we're talking about. They came to you. If it hadn't been for the drug support, your particular unit would not have been permitted to train them.
That's correct, sir.
No. All right. I think that's a very important clarification. The time on this particular round has... Yes, Mr. Taylor.
Again, for the record, for a parliamentary inquiry, you very specifically said his particular unit, JTS-6, would not have been used. Is it also not correct to say, though, that DOD in general support would have been available?
All right, let me do this. Reclaiming the time of the chair for a minute, for the purposes of clarification, and not to yield to Mr. Taylor, but I think I'll satisfy him, I would like to ask unanimous consent to have 3 minutes specifically to clarify this point. Is there any objection to that? If not, I would like to ask the questions of Ambassador Holmes and General Pickler. Let's go over this step by step very, very briefly. Anybody coming to you from another law enforcement community asking you for assistance, it would not be illegal for the Department of Defense to provide that, whether it had a drug connection or not, under the posse comitatus laws. Is that correct, Ambassador Holmes? In general?
Yeah, in general, that's correct. But and I think I can clarify, JTF-6 is specifically set up to respond to requests from law enforcement in the prosecution of the drug war.
All right, what happens if somebody comes to you as a matter of policy? Now, we talked about law. Let's clarify that. Is there any policy in the Department of Defense or in the Department of the Army, which perhaps General Pickler or somebody else would know about more definitive than you would, Ambassador Holmes, that would prohibit any unit other than this particular one, JTF-6, from responding to a request for assistance as a policy matter, not a legal matter, whether or not there was a drug connection?
You mean in the drug connection?
No, not in the drug war. Forget the drug war. Let's say there is no drug war or no drug issue involved, and you get a law enforcement agency of the federal government, FBI, ATF, anybody coming to you asking for assistance, and there's no drug connection, is in training or in preparation or in providing equipment, not operationally, would you be able to provide that under the policies that existed in DOD and the Department of the Army at the time the request was made by the ATF concerning the Waco raid?
Yes, to the best of my knowledge, that is correct.
You would have been.
I mean, obviously, every request is vetted and looked at it depending on the nature of the request.
There was no inherent regulation or policy restriction otherwise.
In fact, it is authorized by Act of Congress, this kind of support.
But JTF-6 was a particular unit designed to work with the drug issue. Is that correct, General Pickler?
That's correct. Within the Southwest Border Region, whose limits were defined not only geographically, but the Southwest Border High-Intensity Drug Trafficking Area, the Southwest Border HIDA.
And that's all you did is work with a drug question?
At that time, sir, the limit of our support was to federal, state, and local law enforcement agencies, Title 10 support, within the Southwest Border Region.
But you had other missions besides that inside the Army? Or was that the sole mission of JTF-6?
That was the sole mission of
JTF-6. Mission. All right. That's what I wanted to know. I think that's clarified it. I think that's taken plenty of that time. Mr. Zeliff?
I just have one quick question, Mr.
Crane. On that same unanimous consent, I will yield to you to clarify that.
Clarify one quick question, and I think I may have asked the wrong person. Mr. Crane, was the money used for Waco training previously designated as counter-drug funds for JTF-6?
Sir, I'm not a budget guy. I'm not really able JTF-6, Special Forces Command support to JTF-6, is funded by Forcecom P2CD dollars. And
which is?
Drug money, sir.
Okay. That's. I was just trying to get to the...
Okay.
Okay.
Any other support that we provide to other agencies is handled separately, but JTF-6 support is paid by Forcecom.
I think the question Mr. Zeliff has needs one follow-up to make it real clear. If an agency of the federal government, a law enforcement agency, generally Ambassador Holmes or anyone else who can answer this, comes to you seeking assistance, equipment, or training, forget the drug question for a moment. Does, if the drugs are not involved and it's not JTF-6 or whatever, is there a requirement in the interagency rules or regulations or by law that that other agency or its parent reimburse the Department of Defense or the military agency for the cost of that equipment and training?
Generally speaking, this kind of support is reimbursed, but in under certain circumstances it can be waived.
But in the case of the drug support effort that JTF-6 provided, there would be no reimbursement
no,
required
that's funded,
under the law.
That is funded by Congress.
Thank you
and
very
so
much.
So whatever we spent on Waco training costs came out of the drug interdiction component of the nation's drug war.
So
that's correct.
Those
funds were funneled from the department through the Army as a funding mechanism to Joint right. Task Force 6 to pay for that support that was provided
I
under
understand.
The execute order.
Yeah. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Well, the answer to that question is yes, for the record.
I want to recognize Mr. Bryant, then you have your 5 minutes. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I yield my time. Mr. Bouyer.
Thank you, Mr. Bryant, for yielding to me. In conclusion, I have a few comments that I'd like to make. First of all, I'd like to thank each of you for coming. I know that, Lieutenant Colonel Lindley, you've come from Japan to be here. Major Petrie, you've come from Hawaii. You've come a long way also to be here. And General Huffman, you've missed a wedding. To in fact be here, and many of you have missed other things, so let me extend a thank you to you. Also to, Sergeant First Class Dunn. I think you probably have to be thankful to help clear your name. Your name's been in a lot of different magazines and stuff, and hopefully you've had that opportunity now to in fact clear your name and that you weren't there at the raid day as a lot of some like to write. So that's the purpose of these hearings. To get a lot of that out in the open, and I appreciate your candor and your willingness to testify here today. I think part of the testimony has been very clear, and the clear is that today we had DEA testify that they were never contacted for assistance, and that with regard to the use of a FLIR to detect methamphetamine lab, FLIR being the forward-looking infrared radar. The use of the F-4 flying from Alabama to Texas, they don't do that kind of thing. Also, it's clear that JTF-6 assumed at face value the presence of the drug lab. I also would say that it's easy to Monday morning quarterback, and that's not really what our job here to do. But I am concerned, though, that when two of the witnesses did discover at a Houston meeting that really this kind of was a ruse, that it perhaps was a fabrication. They really aren't concerned about the drug nexus. That maybe they should have kicked that up to JTF-6, to the command to say, you know, they really shouldn't gain access to all of our training and expertise. They got other ways to be able to access that. Perhaps that should have been done. That's Monday morning quarterback stuff, but that's something that definitely concerns me. And I'm sure that future commanders of JTF-6, when they get an inquiry from BATF on a drug lab, but maybe they might ask a few questions and not just accept things on face value. I see a smile there. The other issue is, I know that some questions were asked of the Ambassador Holmes that with regard to should we make any legislative changes, and his sort of, I like the way things are, doesn't satisfy me. because I also know that Dr. Perry has appointed you to the offline task force to look into the open access and how much access really is there to the military to participate in local law enforcement. And that's part of the role. So I think we do need that further review. I'm also one, though, that has some concern here with regard to the Posse Comitatus statute. We have this statute in place. It's good policy for our country. It's no one has ever been prosecuted under the criminal statute. And it's almost as if we have so many laws and regulations to know how to skirt around the issue, and Congress is partly to blame in part of this, that we have learned that despite this ruse and fabrication to gain the access to the military treasure trove, they didn't need to have to lie in the first place. That's what we learned here today, that there are all kinds of methods and ways to access that military treasure trove. So they didn't have to lie, but in fact we had that lie. So I'm pretty concerned. I'm concerned when we have the National Guard out there being able to say, well, we're the National Guard, we're outside the Posse Comitatus statute, and I want the federal government to pay for what I do, I want state control, I'll help in a federal mission, and by the way, I'll pick up the phone and I'll call an adjutant general where I have a memorandum of understanding, and he'll send fighter jets. You see, when the founders created the Constitution, and when they had a well-regulated militia in mind, you have to remember it was muskets back then. Had a range of 100 yards, 150 yards maximum. Today we have states that have power projection capabilities to go far beyond their own state borders. We have more power projection capabilities than most countries. And now we have these state adjutant generals making decisions on memorandums of understanding and never even picking up the phone and calling you, Ambassador Holmes. Now, if I were you, that would kind of concern me, or calling anybody else, whether it's at Guard Bureau or whatever. So I think it's pretty good for us to have a review, and for you also in your process here. I compliment the Secretary of Defense for appointing you to this task force to look into the access issues, because I think America here has learned that there was no conspiracy here between you and the AT and BAT. There's no conspiracy. There was, in fact, some falsehood here to gain that military access, which was unfortunate. But I think America can now be surprised at how much access there really can be to the military insistence of local law enforcement. And we here in the Congress can debate a lot of the policy perspectives to that. But let me thank all of you for coming to here today, for clearing the air. It's important. And let me finish by thanking each of you for your service and commitment to country. God bless you.
Well, I thank you very much. I think we've concluded the normal questioning here. I've got a couple of clarifications to announce. First of all, the written testimony, I believe, Ambassador Holmes, that you gave, and I guess General Huffman gave, will be admitted to the record. So would any other written testimony that you wish to present today. I think there's some documents that have been asked to be put in the record that were used down by Mr. Shattuck and Mr. Buyer, and without objection, they're admitted to the record. There was a question raised earlier about the clarification on some of the equipment read off by Mr. Zeloff with relationship to the being supplied by the military. Those lists for clarification were of the equipment provided not only in connection with this raid on the 28th of February, but also with the final assault day on April the 19th. And I believe I'm just, Mr. Buyer?
I can't recall. I want to make sure that the National Guard after-action report is submitted for the record.
No objection.
If no objection, the after-action report will be submitted for the record.
Thank
you need a clarification, Ms. Thurman?
Parliamentary inquiry.
Mr. Chairman, I do have a clarification.
Sure.
Because there's been two characterizations here by Mr. Schiff and by Mr. Bolliard. And I think we ought to have it on record because I don't think they ever got an opportunity to respond to their characterization of what happened. And I'm kind of curious if they agree or disagree with the way it was characterized.
Well, I think the clarification of some members' characterization, Ms. Thurman, is a little different than the factual part of this. I don't know how.
But I thought we were trying to get to the facts.
Well, we do. But, I mean, members do tend to give their comments, and I think they have the right during their 5 minutes to make the comments. We're just trying now to do the administrative process. Mr. Taylor, you have an administrative clarification?
Going back to Mr. Zeloff's list of the equipment that was used, I think, for the record, since this is a subject of much debate out amongst the people of this country, for the record, it is very important that there be a delineation of that equipment that was made available on the first day, February 28th.
Well, let's see what it is. Let's make sure we know. Do we know what we have out here, Mr. Zeller, or maybe you know? I think the equipment involved three helicopters that were used came from the National Guard units.
Well,
what else?
Why don't we read the list, and then we'll have the experts tell us which ones were for which.
Because, obviously, Mr. Zeller, let's face it, by the time the second raid had occurred, there were four dead ATF agents and 20 people.
Well, whatever the background is, let's clarify it. Mr. Zeller, I yield just so you read it, just for the clarification.
Just read the list, right?
Just read the list and see if we can get anybody to tell. If anybody knows on the panel, they may not know that.
Two UH-1 helicopters, 10 M2A1 Bradleys, two main battle tanks.
Well, now, the Bradleys and the battle tanks would have been provided for the, not for this, but for the second raid, the helicopters presumably for this one.
Two main battle tanks, Abrams, two HMMWVs.
Presumably that would be for the second one, too. Anybody here got any information? Well, let's ask a yes or no.
Is it not safe to say that on the first day, the only equipment
was
made
available
by
the Texas
National Guard?
Why don't you let them answer the question?
I'm asking a question.
Mr. Ambassador Holmes, can you clarify this?
Mr. Chairman, may I make a suggestion? Why don't we submit for the record this equipment?
That would be a good suggestion.
Great.
We'll accept that very quickly.
That'll solve the problem.
Last thing on clarification, Major Petrie, flashbangs. You familiar with flashbangs? You know what they are?
Yes, sir, I am.
All right. Were flashbangs something which this unit, for clarification, actually, that they came, ATF came to you in the training and all, did they get involved with you in the training and the connection with that? Was that part of their training, to use flashbangs?
Yes, sir. During their, what they needed was approval to throw them. To utilize them in their training.
Am I correct that the rules and regulations regarding flashbangs that normally you would train them to do would involve caution in the case of use with children and fire, around fire, and that sort of thing? Is that correct?
Sir, that was the only contact I had with the flashbang issue there at Fort Hood was...
All right. That's fair enough. I just wanted to know. That had come up earlier, and I wanted to clarify it. That's it.
Ms.
Thurman.
Because of just this last round of questioning that I kind of think happened here, I would like to ask for unanimous consent to give these folks 2 minutes to respond to what I asked in the beginning.
I would like to know. Yes, as far as I'm concerned, you can have unanimous consent. Any objection?
Object, Mr. Chairman.
Well, then we'll start objecting when we see this kind of nonsense.
Mr. Chairman.
All right, we have finished the rounds of questions. I simply was trying to get things that were loose ends clarified. Chairman typically do that at the end of one of these hearings. We are at the point now where we've got people wanting to get in and question characterizations and so forth. That was not the purpose of what I was doing. So, at any rate...
Mr. Chairman, I'm confused. I thought you had agreed to allow the gentlelady's question to be answered.
Well, there was an objection down here. We'd had a unanimous consent earlier. They objected to this particular one because this question, I gather, was one of asking a response to characterizations that two members had made down here. So we're getting into the point where I just have to be stricter than I have been, that's all.
Mr. Chairman, I make a parliamentary inquiry. Can an answer be forthcoming from these gentlemen in writing then to the committee? In order to receive
the witnesses are free to submit written testimony, and that has been already put into the record. And we have agreed to accept it, and they have done so.
Mr. Chairman, I need a clarification. I, in the midst of my questioning, referred to the Department of the Treasury on the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms, the investigation. And I would like unanimous consent to put in pages 211 to 214. It's only four pages. It has to do with the National Guard support and military contact, and it refers to this.
Well, there would be no objection, but I would say, without objection, but I would say that that entire report is already part, as far as we're concerned, of this record. The reports of both the Treasury and the Justice Department are received as a part of our record your reference.
And Mr. Chairman, if I can make special emphasis
on
pages 211 to 214.
By way of clarification, it was difficult to understand whether you said Shabbat or Shattig when you talked about documents being admitted before. I think mine were already previously admitted.
I had said Shattig before. That is correct. When I did what I did just a moment ago, I was acknowledging, I think, Mr. Shattig and Mr. Boyer had documents they'd referred to. They asked for unanimous consent. They'd be admitted.
We did that. Individual documents have not been, but my recollection is if it's not true, I will do it myself right now without objection. Both the reports on the Waco raids of the Treasury Department and the Justice Department in their totality will be admitted as a part of this record. They should be for reference purposes. Having not heard an objection, that's fine.
As well as the documents that we had referred.
Well, you've already, those have been admitted. The documents you referred to, each of you have submitted those, and we've gotten unanimous consent on that. Mr. Conyers?
May I be granted 5 minutes under
you,
this
you walked in seeking the 5 minutes. Now, Ambassador Holmes has to make a plane. He's sitting there ready to run out.
I don't want him not to make his plane.
You can ask the rest of the panel. Do you need to ask him?
Well, we would be delighted, Ambassador, that you make your plane. And I would be very privileged if I would get 5 minutes.
Well, I'm going to yield you the 5 minutes, but then you have to make the decision on Ambassador Holmes' plane.
I understand that I'm going to yield to the gentlelady from Florida, so if she doesn't mind him leaving, I'd be perfectly delighted if he were excused. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
You're welcome.
And I thank the gentleman.
May I make a point? With respect to the statements that were made and you were asking about, we don't consider that a question. We have no comment to make. That's a statement, and so.
But it characterized what they thought that they heard today and what was happening. And all I'm questioning is, do you agree with that or don't you?
We have no comment on it.
Fine.
We don't receive it as a question.
Anything else?
That's fine.
Well,
I yield to Mr. Taylor.
Thank you, Ms. Conyers. Mr. Ambassador, go catch your plane, because this can be directed to the military guys. I'm serious. If you have to catch your plane, I don't want to be the one to hold you up. What I want is a clarification on the day of the first raid, because Mr. Zeloff ran off a very long list of heavy military equipment. Is it not accurate that on the first day, the only assets made available were Texas National Guard helicopters? That the Bradleys, that the tanks, that all the heavy things that he refers to were used only after 4 ATF agents had been murdered, 20 more had been wounded, when the ATF guys were outgunned by the Branch Davidians. Is that not an accurate statement? And if it is not an accurate statement, please tell me.
Yeah, that's essentially accurate, and I think it will be clarified definitively when we submit for the record, as I suggested we would do, the full list of equipment.
Okay, Mr. Ambassador, the American people won't get the chance to read that record. I mean, this could be public. But they won't
well,
read it.
I said so I, that is essentially accurate.
Thank you, sir. Yes, sir, I yield to Mr. Schumer.
Thank you. And I would just like to first thank all of the gentlemen here for testifying. And I'd also like to say we've heard some summaries that were made at the end by our colleagues that I don't think matched anything that you said in terms of the methamphetamines, in terms of the military use, or anything else. And I would simply urge anyone who is interested in this in some detail to look at what the witnesses said and not at what the summaries, which didn't give any of the witnesses a chance to tell their veracity. We all have our views here. My views are known. I think everyone's views are known. But at the end of the long testimony, to have few people summarize and the summaries don't fit what the witnesses say, I think the public should be aware of that. We did not hear from any of the witnesses the summaries that were made by two of my colleagues at the end. And I yield back my time to the gentleman from Michigan.
Are there any of my colleagues that would like time? Mr. Chairman, I would yield back whatever time I have remaining.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Ehrlich has come in. Mr. Ehrlich, would you like to be recognized?
Yes, sure. And I appreciate that, and I will yield my 5 minutes to the chairman.
Well, I thank you, Mr. Ehrlich, and I won't take it. But Ambassador Holmes, I'm going to let you go. You go catch the plane. I have a couple of comments I want to make on the time, and I'd like to ask Major Petrie one or two questions, but they do not require your presence if you need to go. Major Petrie,
thank
I just
Mr.
wanted
chairman.
To follow up because I was seeking clarification, and some of my colleagues over here thought that I was broaching the subject of flashbangs inappropriately, I suppose. I did not mean to do that, but as long as I've got the time for Mr. Ehrlich, I want to make sure we didn't leave that just hanging out there in the air. Tell us what a flashbang is.
This won't be out of a technical bulletin, this answer. But,
I understand. I don't want it.
A flashbang essentially is a non-destructive device or a device that has very limited destruction to its environment, normally initiated by a fuse, pull fuse system. It does have a capability of a spoon with a cook-off. It explodes. Essentially, a flashbang is exactly what the name implies. It creates a very brilliant flash. It creates a very large noise. This noise and the flash both disorient the inner drone.
Yes, Mr. Crane, please.
A flashbang is simply nothing more than a diversionary device used in a context of like CQB that we've talked about earlier, where a forced entry scenario requires the assault force to obtain the better hand, if you will, when they go through a door or if they enter a facility. A diversionary device basically gets the attention of those people inside the room, whether they be hostages or friendlies or whether they be bad guys.
All right. Are there times, Mr. Crane or Major Petrie, where you have cautions or red flags about using those where they could be hazardous if you have rules of engagement? I think we're going to have testimony, and we have already had some, that ATF had some of those rules. I'm not asking you to tell me what their rules are. I'm curious to know if you, in your training, advise either them, law enforcement agencies, of this, or if you would advise your own military personnel there are times to be careful, particularly with the use of such devices as flashbangs.
With regards to advising military, yes. With regards to advising LEAs, I think the circumstances
would be very... What do you tell the military?
Certainly, if you're going to be around flammable material, either flammable or volatile material, and you have knowledge of that material generally within a certain area, you'd certainly want to be careful before you toss it in there.
Do you say anything about children or being careful if there are children in the area, if you're using this, say, in the urban warfare environment that you've described earlier in answering someone's question? Is there a hazard particular that you know of for using these flashbangs more around kids than it is around adults?
I'm not medically really capable to explain.
Okay, well, that's all right. I just want to know if you had any. That's all I asked. Now, we've clarified it. I'm going on to make a closing comment. I would like to make it, and I want to thank all of you for coming today. People have been talking about characterizations. We get a lot of that here. I think it's very clear that you came forward, all of you on this panel today, Ambassador Holmes has just left, and every one of you, and given us very straight testimony. Some of it has clarified clearly the role of the military. There's a lot of confusion around what posse comitatus allows and doesn't allow. It is, as you've testified very ably legally for quite some time today, a rule of law that has some parameters and restrictions on where the military can be involved. Apparently, under the rules of engagement, as you understood it, and I think as you've explained it today, you could give the assistance that you gave to the ATF prior to the time that they made the raid at February 28th raid. And the equipment at least used in that raid. We have not gotten to the questions really surrounding the second event, and that's not why you are here today. With respect to the issues that are raised about the drug question, I think it's also equally clear that from your perspective, the drug issue was explored adequately, and you had for JTF-6 permission to go ahead and make the training. I think there is some question, though, very serious question, that's not your responsibility to answer, it's ours. And to get the answer from ATF about their providing potentially misleading material to those who did make that decision and screen it for you about the involvement of drugs. Whether that would have made any difference for any other unit, it certainly is clear from your testimony, General Pickler, it did make a difference technically for you. So that's the way I see it. I want to thank all of you for coming today. The time that's been yielded to me has expired. We need to move on to another panel, and we thank you very much for spending your time. Thank you.
Unanimous consent request that when I questioned Commander Pickler about the chain of command, I did not have this information relating to approval to execute counter drug mission, and I have some information to that effect that I would ask to be made part of the record.
It's a document from the Treasury or that's been provided to us to the committee, as I see it.
Yes.
Then that will be accepted without objection. At this time, I want to call our last panel for the day. As I announced earlier, this is the third panel. The fourth panel will be put off till tomorrow, but our third panel is a very